Well, what a day in the state of South Carolina, as we said yesterday that today could be a really, really big day for the South Carolina Gamecocks. And lo and behold, if today is not one of the biggest days ever in South Carolina basketball history, I don't know what else is, because South Carolina has landed Cam Scott out of Lexington High School, who was committed to the University of Texas. And now all of a sudden, Lamont Paris has flipped Cam Scott and Diesel. This is absolutely huge. A great day for the Gamecocks. A not so good day for the Clemson Tigers, as Chase Hunter decides he's going to be able to be leaving the program. So just right off the bat today, instant reaction. We kind of set this up on a tee yesterday. We kind of felt like we knew this was coming, but Cam Scott going to South Carolina, I don't know if I can remember Lamont Paris just in his 3 years, a big as move of a move as this. This is huge.
Lamont did what Cam Smith from the football program told him to do, which was, do you remember?
No, I don't.
Drop your nuts.
Yeah.
That's what Cam Smith said to do. And he did it when it came to Cam Scott choosing South Carolina. Huge, huge gift for Lamont Paris. I mean, you know, to be able to put a wall around this state and say you're not getting our best, gotta love it. And even though Texas did date him for a little while before you know he came home to set up with the smart team, I mean, they got him. That's ultimately what matters.
This is Wire to Wire. He's Diesel. I'm Cole Bryson. And this is a fairly new show right here on the Fan Upstate. We appreciate you being a part of the program.
Show number 18.
Oh, is that right?
We are keeping count.
Number 18.
Yeah, we're keeping track.
Well, I'm glad you are, because there's no way I'd be able to keep count.
It's on the top of the rundown.
There it is. Show 18. That means tomorrow will be 19.
Yeah. That's how math works. Tomorrow's 18 plus one.
That's exactly right. So let us know what you think about this for South Carolina. Just a huge day for Gamecock basketball. 71307. Start your text with the word fan. 844-326-3663 is where we can be found on the phone lines. That's Renewal by Anderson phone lines. We're also on Twitter. He's at Diesel on Radio. I am at The Cole Bryson. I do apologize for my shoddy voice today. I've been dealing with some throat and head stuff all week, so hopefully I'm on the mend, but I do apologize for sounding like poo-poo today on the radio. But that won't stop us, Diesel. Cam Scott to South Carolina, Lamont Paris in his third year. This is absolutely fantastic for South Carolina, but why can other programs in-state not have a quick as a turnaround as South Carolina's had? I mean, we look at Clemson and South Carolina and compare them all the time. Brad Brownell, everybody tells us he's a great X's and O's guy, but on our very first week on this program, Diesel, I said on air, the very first week this show debuted, I said, I get that Brad has his team in the Elite Eight. I understand they've had a good year, but I still thought that the culture that Lamont Paris has in place is a much stronger culture than what Brad Brownell has at Clemson. Am I wrong on that?
Well, I don't know you can go that far yet. He's doing a fantastic job building that culture. I mean, Brad Brownell has done a better job of keeping players for long stints, 3-4 years. I mean, PJ Hall, keeping him in Clemson, that's no small feat. You know, when a guy like PJ Hall has the option to leave and go make a lot of money somewhere else, he didn't. He chose to stay. So I think that's important to discuss. I think Lamont Paris is starting to build that culture. I do think the ceiling for South Carolina basketball under Lamont Paris and the culture that he is trying to build is higher than the ceiling for Clemson with the culture that Brad Brownell has built.
Sure. And listen, I hear you. I don't disagree with what you're saying, but my biggest thing is if Brad Brownell, the biggest thing he can hang his hat on is he kept PJ Hall. in 15 years at Clemson, as long as he's been there. If that's the biggest thing he can hang his hat on, and that's no disrespect to him or PJ Hall, because
but he's hanging his hat on an Elite Eight.
Sure, I get it. But, man, I tell you what, man, there's something brewing down there in Columbia, and Cam Scott realizes that this is 3 years in a row that Lamont Paris has done this, and going out and get a top recruit, a top prospect. How long will it be in South Carolina? I don't know. Hopefully a few years. But this could transform South Carolina into a destination school for other guys around the country, Diesel.
Yeah, it very well could. I mean, we thought and hoped that something like that was going to be building down there in Pickens County. Ended up not to be the case. Lamont Paris is just doing a far better job when it comes to recruiting guys out of the portal. I know that Cam Scott is a high school player who signed his NLI to Texas, chose not to go to Texas, chose to stay home in the state of South Carolina. I mean, we'll see, obviously, what Lamont Paris is able to do in the transfer portal over the next couple of months leading up to the next season. You know, ultimately, is he going to have to do again what he did this year? It's really easy to get excited about what he was able to do at South Carolina this past season, knowing just how much of his team left following the 2022-23 season.
Three straight years now, he's landed the number one recruit in South Carolina. And again, South Carolina is not the basketball factory that North Carolina is and other states, but we do have talent.
You think
here.
South Carolina boosters are just more willing to pay for players?
Maybe so. I mean, G.G. Jackson, Colin Murray-Boyles, and then this year again with Cam Scott.
It's interesting that it's happened twice now, though, with G.G. Jackson originally being committed to North Carolina, choosing not to go up to Chapel Hill because the reclassification and them not having a scholarship available for him. So it's interesting, Cole, that you say he's landed the number one recruit in the state 3 years in a row. And yes, that is true. That is true. But two of those three recruits chose somewhere else first and then backed out of it and decided to come to South Carolina. Point is, they got him. That's ultimately what matters.
Yeah.
They got him, but they didn't choose South Carolina first. So I wouldn't go so far.
That don't matter, though, man.
Some rosy picture of just how elite the culture is that he's building, Lamont Paris is building there in Columbia. He's their second choice. And it's better to be a second choice than a third choice, right? Clemson's not getting considered by these players. So it's certainly a better place to be. But I wouldn't go so far as to, you know, hand him a trophy, you know?
I didn't say that, but I do think his culture right now is better than Brad Brunell's culture. I really do. I think the culture at South Carolina today, April 17th, is better than what Big Bad Brad has. Because Big Bad Brad, you know, next year he may be in the tournament, he may not be. Yeah, you got some fifth-year guy that's going to come in and replace P.J. Hall, but Chase Hunter's leaving and R.J. Godfrey left. I'm big on culture, man. I really am. And listen, I get it. Cam Scott, you know, he wanted to excuse me. He wanted to go to Texas at first, but ultimately he got him to Columbia.
I do wonder if the game, assuming – things continue the way it's going right now with the transfer portal and NIL being the thing that brings a lot of players to where they are for a year, and then they can up and transfer and go somewhere else. I wonder, Cole, until something changes, are we going to start seeing the quote-unquote culture builders of college basketball and college football? Are we going to start seeing them slip down the ladder, right? It's not going to be so much about culture builders. It's going to be about who can do the most by being put in a situation where you don't know your players, you're recruiting your roster right up until tip-off, basically, and you have to re-recruit every single year.
Well, listen, I think culture still has a lot to do, Diesel, with recruiting. Does it have everything to do, or does it have as much to do with recruiting as it used to? Maybe not, because at the end of the day, it's all about money now, right? For the majority of these top players, it's about one thing, and that is NIL, right? What am I going to make to come play for you? However, even though money is still very, very important, culture still means a lot. Culture still has a big impact on, in my opinion, a guy like Cam Scott coming to South Carolina. And obviously he wanted to stay close to home, but let's be honest, he wasn't wanting to stay an hour away from home. He was wanting to stay 15 minutes from home. Obviously, what was going on up the road an hour didn't interest him, you know?
Yeah,
I don't know if it was money. I don't know if it was culture or not having ever having interest in Clemson. But Clemson should still be able to fight for these guys. Like a guy in Lexington, you would think Clemson should have a chance at least entertaining them.
Well, his options, I mean, obviously, you know, I'm looking at his recruiting profile here. Clemson offered him, Florida State, Georgia, North Carolina, Wake Forest, all right here in the states of North, South Carolina and North Florida. I mean, he had plenty of options to stay close to home.
He did.
And he chose the closest one home. And you know, we can't know just how legitimately crucial his family being right there in the Columbia area is. And I
probably means a lot.
If that's what was the deciding factor for Cam Scott, great. You know, I'm happy for him and happy that he was able to get what he wanted and be able to stay close to home and probably put some money in his pocket.
Sure.
So, I mean, it sounds like a win-win for Cam. Sounds like a win-win for South Carolina. Hopefully they can hang on to him. Scouts graded him an 89, a four-star, 32nd on the ESPN 100 players, ninth best in the country at his position, number one in the state of South Carolina. Congratulations to the Gamecocks for getting them. It's Wire to Wire. He's Cole Bryson. I am Diesel. I want to remind you that next Wednesday, Cole, we are going to be on the road at Ingles Markets. People will have a chance to come out and see us on the road at Ingles in Piedmont. And then on Thursday, we are going to be live at Dave & Buster's Woodruff Road in Greenville for our draft special. Want to see you out there. Come decked out in whatever team's gear you want to bring to the show. We definitely want to see you out there. We definitely want to see you pack the house. Show Dave & Buster's that they made a good choice by booking us to bring us out there. It is important for you to show up, to be there from 3 to 7. And show them that the fan upstate means a lot to you. We'd really, really appreciate that. Madcraft on the chat says that could be a positive aspect, though. Paris continues recruiting players even when they choose elsewhere. Madcraft, that would be called roster tampering. Are you saying that Lamont Paris is elite at roster tampering? It's illegal. It's illegal, but it doesn't stop anybody from doing it. He also says show the players how much you want them, and they will come. We had a texter. This comes from JT in Greer at 71307. You want to text the show? Do that. 71307. Start your text with keyword fan. JT says Lamont Paris is showing why the Gamecocks made the right hire. Great job landing Scott. Yeah, of course. Another texter. I hesitate to read this one on the air, Cole, because it sounds bad.
Uh-oh.
Okay. I'm gonna pull a Josh Pate here and say immunity. Texter wants to know, Diesel, what are you sucking on? It was a throat lozenge there, Texter. The throat lozenge. Thanks for making fun of both of our current ailments.
Yes.
Cole's feeling it more than I am.
Oh, I am. I've been feeling it rough, man.
My wife has been down bad with a cold for the last, like, 4 days. Luckily, I haven't gotten it, I don't think. Cole, you're sounding a little rough there.
Yesterday, you got
somebody squeezing onto your throat.
Yesterday was really, really painful. Today is not as much painful, but I just don't have a voice today. My voice is sounding like it's, you know, just becoming shot. But
you know what's good for that? Whiskey.
Is it?
Yeah.
Well, I'm telling you, yesterday when I get off the air, I was like, my throat was just on fire. And everybody knows there's nothing worse than throat pain. All right. Going back to what the conversation with Lamont Paris, something that's very interesting, and I don't know if this is just rumors or if this has legs to it. But today, Alabama's Nick Pringle announced that he was entering the transfer portal. I did have a source text me and say, this is something to watch. Nothing finalized, but just watch. This is, I'm reading this off of my phone. That came at 9:16 this morning. So, again, we're talking about Lamont making a splash. I'll tell you this. As big as the get was for him to go grab Cam Scott, If he somehow goes and gets Nick Pringle from Alabama, you better watch out. You better watch out. I don't know if it'll happen. You know, Nick Pringle has a million choices. He's a heck of a basketball player, a really good basketball player, Nick Pringle. But of all the players I watched during the tournament, Nick Pringle impressed me, especially against Clemson that night. I mean, he was really, really solid. So, again, I don't know if it has legs. I just had it texted to me this morning by someone who, you know, does have a little bit of knowledge when it comes to those things, has, you know, people that he talks to. So we'll see. But that would be really, really big if they could – if Lamont said, hey, I'm not done yet, by the way. But Cam Scott, a kid from Lexington, what this shows, Diesel, is, and we've talked about this many times on the program, this shows that there are talented athletes in South Carolina, and it shows, in my opinion, that if you do have a basketball program in state that's trending up, that's on the rise, it shows that you can keep these guys. Now, we've talked about it a couple of weeks ago, the guys that got away, right? The list is long. The guys like John Morant, the guys like Zion that go out of state. I don't know if Lamont could have ever been on the radar for those guys. But in order for us, Diesel, to keep these talented players in state, we have to have an elite program. And I'm not calling South Carolina elite yet, but I'm telling you, I believe in what Lamont's building and is trending toward that direction.
Yeah, I mean, there's no fault in anything that you said there. This is one of the reasons, Cole, why, despite making the Elite Eight, I still haven't been super high on Brad Brownell. He's been there for 13 years, and he's not even close to getting some of these guys.
No.
Like, he's not, you know, I remember when Zion was being recruited, and it was still up in the air where he was going to go. We all pretty much had an idea that he was going to Duke or North Carolina.
Yeah, I was at his press conference that night.
But, you know, he was not legitimately considering Clemson. And to have a guy who's been there for 13 years in the way Brad Brownell has, and had his ups and downs, and he's had his seasons where he's made the Sweet 16, and he's just had his season where he made the Elite Eight. You have to be able to parlay that into onward and upward trajectory.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's why I feel like I'm just talking into the ether to people who have their heads so far up Brad Brownell's backside because he made an Elite Eight. Isn't it great? Lifetime contract. Give him what he wants. Give him an extension. Why? He hasn't really done anything with it. Like, he had a great run this year. Great. I'm happy for him. I'm proud of the guy. I'm proud of the program. But you have to be able to parlay that into more success down the line. Otherwise, it's just going to be what it's always been with Brad Brownell. It's going to be a blip.
Well, you know, you just haven't seen the consistency.
Exactly.
You haven't seen the consistency. And again, Lamont's only been there for 3 years. And that's why, to me, I think that, you know, Frank Martin was a really good coach. There are people out there who will tell you that Frank Martin was a horrible coach, but those people are absolutely crazy. Frank Martin was a good coach. And I remember when Frank Martin left South Carolina, there was a lot of people who felt like, you know, we can't go get the next guy. Nobody, Carolina and Clemson fans say the same thing, that nobody big is going to come to their program. Well, you didn't go anywhere big. You went to Chattanooga and got a guy, Lamont Paris, who has come in 3 years, not even three, 4 years, has put your program on the map.
Yeah.
Who's gotten the number one recruit, the number one prospect in the state 3 years in a row. And Brad Brownell hasn't even been in the conversation with those three prospects. So he's just he's building it, man. And I tell you, it's exciting because, this, as I said a minute ago, the state needs a program like this in order to go keep those guys. Madcraft says he just seems like Dabo. He builds his roster traditionally with minimal portal additions. Paris is operating like Lane Kiffin. Well, it's a lot different when you only have to have five starters on the floor rather than 22. You know, it's a big difference. But we'll get back to that. You know, a ton of reaction. It's a great day for South Carolina. It's a great day for Gamecock fans and getting Cam Scott.
Yep. Guys, celebrate that. When we come back, we'll get to the Daily Buzz, the Daily Wires, coming up next here on the Fan Upstate. And is South Carolina's window to get a highest level pro team closing fast. We'll talk about that next here on Wire to Wire. Let's get you caught up on what's happening out there in the world. Let's get you to your daily wires. Hang on, we have a sound effect for this now, Cole. Hey, how about
been electrocuted?
Big timing. Okay, daily wire number one: the Lakers defeated the Pelicans last night, 110-106. Zion Williamson scored 40 points in a feverish comeback, but he went out of the game with 3 minutes remaining. Did not come back. About 45 minutes ago, Adrian Wojnarowski posted on Twitter, Zion is out for Thursday's play-in elimination game. So Zion finally had his get back star, a Star is Born game, and he got hurt.
Hamstring, man. Yeah. Just well, absolutely terrible.
You're fat, man. You can't go out there and perform like that when you're carrying around an extra 40, 50 pounds. It's just true. Also in the play-in tournaments, the Kings defeated the Warriors 118-94. Oof, man, the Warriors dynasty is crumbling right before our eyes. Last night, the Braves defeated Houston by a score of 6-2. In the first inning of that game, Orlando Arcia hit a solo home run. It sounded like this.
Two down, bases empty, payoff pitch. In the air to left, McCormick going back. Still going. Is it gone? Yes. A solo homer.
Not so fast, my friend, said the Astros broadcast. They disagreed with the call of a home run. And they kind of threw a little bit of a fit at the end. This is great audio. Listen to this.
This could be a good look.
Yeah, that's not a home run.
Yeah, that's a great shot.
That hits the yellow line in play. It has to go beyond the yellow line. Oh, yeah.
But it clearly hit the yellow line. Isn't that what you're looking for?
Absolutely. This is not going to be a home run.
View the ruling on the field is confirmed. It is a home run.
No, it's not. How's that not in play?
So the yellow line is a home run?
No, it's not.
Bunch of crybabies, man. Shut up. Y'all suck this year. That's the only reason you're mad. They're terrible.
They are playing right now again, the Braves and the Astros. It just went to commercial break. Coach, see what the commercial was?
The commercial. The score was? Yes, 1-1.
1-1. Okay. Let's see. Ozzie Albies placed on a 15-day IL. What can you tell us about that?
Not good. He's made of glass. Right now, I mean, it just seems like the injury bug is continuing to bite Atlanta. With Ozzie, Sean, Strider. Man, everybody's hurt, but guess what? They're still winning. So,
hey, it's early in the season. If you're going to get your injuries out of the way, get them out of the way now.
I guess so.
When you still got lots of time. I mean, you know, going out there and striving to win 100 games again is probably at this point going to be a little unrealistic for the Braves, but they don't need to score 100.
Ronald Acuna
win 100 games.
Just put one over the center field fence.
First home run of the season.
It is now 2-1 Atlanta. He absolutely got a hold of that one. So Braves are up
22 feet. Cole, I didn't put this one on the rundown last night, but there's video all over the place of Jack Caglione from Florida who had a 500 plus foot home run over the scoreboard.
Wow.
At Florida last night. I mean, easy to do when you're playing with juiced aluminum bats, but you know, it is what it is. It was a 500 foot home run.
Still crazy.
It's still a long hit.
Yeah.
It's still a long hit. Last night, South Carolina baseball won over the Citadel 4-3. That was brother on brother crime right there. There's brothers on the South Carolina and Citadel lineups. And South Carolina has now swept the Citadel in the season series. I'm only going to play two games in that season series. Gamecocks improved to 26-11 on the season. They have won 5 of their last 6. So just as we were starting to kick some dirt on the South Carolina Gamecocks season, they've shown signs of life.
That's baseball, man.
They're like that zombie scene in the zombie movies when the hand comes up out of the ground.
That's as soon as you think you figured it out or figured a team out in baseball, they will they'll tell you, man, no, you thought, but no, South Carolina, they're playing well. They're really playing well.
Yep. And to stay right here in state, Clemson won last night over Charlotte 8-5. They've won 2 straight now, 30-6 on the season. It felt like a bit of a get right game for the Tigers.
Yeah. Needed that one.
They really, really did. Here's something interesting, Cole. We brought up on this show a couple times before, and it seems as if South Carolina, the state of South Carolina's opportunity to ever get a highest level of sports team, probably dying right before our very eyes. So if you don't know, South Carolina is the largest, most populous state in the country that doesn't have a highest level pro team. And the upstate, Greenville, is the largest market in the state. So Greenville is the biggest city in the biggest state that doesn't have a pro team. And I have advocated hard. I have advocated hard for an NHL team to the upstate. I've always thought, you know, the fever would catch on. Nashville was not considered a hockey town until they got the Predators, and now it's absolutely electric, and I wanted the exact same thing to happen right here in the upstate of South Carolina. We went so far as creating team names and logos and mascots. And we thought, man, we got something really special and exciting here. But an Atlanta group has formally made the request to the NHL for a third attempt at having an NHL franchise in the city. The Alpharetta Sports and Entertainment Group, fronted by former NHL player Anson Carter, has formally requested that the NHL commence with an expansion process aimed at bringing a franchise to the greater Atlanta area for the third time. They were home to the Flames from 1972 to 1980, who moved to Calgary. They had the Thrashers from 99 through 2011, who moved to Winnipeg. It seems, Cole, as if, you know, they've got their ducks in the row. They are starting the process, doing what they can, campaigning as much as they possibly can to get an NHL team back to Atlanta and the city of Greenville. Knox White, where you at, man? Why have we not heard anything at all from Knox White and the government of Greenville? So it's doing anything at all. I mean, they're letting the boo birds, the people who say you're not going to raise my taxes for anything, they're letting those people win. So, and I don't like it.
I'll push back on that a little bit and say, you know,
don't be that guy who says, I like it the way it is. Don't change it.
That's not exactly that. That is not anywhere close to what I was going to say, but
okay, good. We can still be friends.
I do think that I would love a sports team here, but what we have to realize is Greenville is not anywhere close to the size of Atlanta.
Greenville is bigger than Charlotte was when they got the Panthers.
Yeah, but I'm telling you, man, we're talking about Atlanta. Greenville and Atlanta are not even close to the same size.
They've tried NHL twice already and lost it both times because they didn't support it.
Who, Atlanta?
Yeah.
So if Atlanta doesn't support it, you think – I'm just telling you, like, I hear you. I want a sports team, but all I'm telling you is we're not big enough. Like, I just don't think
we got to stop with this defeatist attitude. We got far too many people in this area, in this region, who have the same defeatist attitude.
It's not a defeatist attitude. Right. It's realistic attitude.
We're
because
too little. We can't do
it's
it.
Diesel. Go to Greenville Drive games, though.
Cole say, well, let's get a UFL team. Let's get a cut rate.
We don't support the Greenville Drive. How are we going to support a big NHL team? I'm telling you, man.
It's highest level.
I want to agree with
you. Highest level.
I want to agree, but you have to be in a big city. Greenville's not a big city. And, you know, you talk about big sports markets across the country. Greenville doesn't even compare.
Green Bay's not a big city.
Yeah, but
Buffalo's not a big city.
But Green Bay and Buffalo, comparing if you've been to Green Bay or Buffalo and then come to Detroit, I mean Detroit, Greenville, it's not even a comparison. They love their football. That's what they – I mean, it's a different world. Listen,
it's a problem with the culture of the people of the upstate who won't support anything.
I just don't think if they can't support Greenville Drive, like Greenville Drive don't even sell out.
Yeah, but whose single A team does sell out anywhere?
Well, what about the hockey team? Do they sell out?
Also third level hockey. We've never tried. That's the problem, Cole, is we've never tried. Nobody here has ever striven for anything bigger than third or fourth level pro teams. And who makes it a point to go out and support that night in and night out anyway? I sure as hell don't. I'm not going. I'm going to tell you right now, Cole, I've lived in a city with a Division II college team. Hickory, North Carolina, my hometown, had Lenoir Rhyne College.
Yeah.
Well, now it's Lenoir Rhyne University. 4 miles down the road. Never went. You know why? Because it's not the best. It's not the best. I'm not going to support Division II and Division III college athletics because I know it's cut-rate college athletics on the grand scheme. So it seems like we don't have any push from
– You have to have money, though, you know?
Telling me the city of Greenville didn't have money?
Not compared to Atlanta.
Well, I know that, but all they need is enough money to get the team. They don't need to be on an equal level as Atlanta. And I'm telling you, Green Bay was probably a couple of horse carts and a cabbage stand before the Packers came along. Okay, so you're comparing us to Green Bay before they had anything. We're talking like 1920s Green Bay.
Mm-hmm.
So I think Greenville is set up far better than anybody here gives the city credit for, and it's damn depressing. It's really damn depressing to hear from all these people who say it can never happen because, oh, we're just little old Greenville. I don't like that attitude. I don't subscribe to that attitude.
So, well, I can tell you this. It'll never happen.
Well,
it'll never happen.
Okay, so here's what we're going to do.
Madcraft agrees with me.
Here's what we're going to do. We're going to keep driving 3 hours in either direction, spend our money out of state. We're going to keep sending money out of this state because nobody in this state has any damned vision. So, okay, here we go. This comes from, again, the former NHL player Anson Carter, who is the front of the Alpharetta Sports and Entertainment Group. He says, quote, "I have no doubt that the best league in the world will thrive in its return to Metro Atlanta." And he said that on a TNT broadcast where he is currently an analyst. Quote, "I have been in dialogue with NHL Commissioner Gary Bettman since 2019 about an expansion team returning to the Fulton County Metro Atlanta market, knowing that franchise decisions are exclusively decided by the NHL Board of Governors." Mm-hmm. In a statement on Tuesday, NHL Deputy Commissioner Bill Daly said that the league appreciates Carter's enthusiasm, but that they don't have any major plans at the moment for any expansion. Quote, "The league appreciates Anson's passion for bringing NHL hockey back to the Atlanta area. He has certainly kept the subject on our radar screen for several years. While as we have always made clear, we have no expansion oriented process in place currently, it's always good to know that there is bona fide interest." That's my point, Cole, is no one here seems willing or interested in showing any interest.
Well, the problem is,
it's like saying
me and you have an interest that
really
mean anything.
I wish that perfect 10 over there would go out on a date with me. Well, have you ever asked her out? No, because I don't think I'm really attracted.
Yeah, but you realize me and you have an interest does nothing. Like, the people with the money have to be.
We have a voice, Cole. We have a voice to be able to try to motivate people.
The people that need to be motivated are the ones with, you know, the ones with the control, number one, and with the money. And I just don't think that, I mean, yeah, we have a voice, but I don't know that it's going to, again, I'm not trying to be Debbie Downer. I just, you know, I don't know that. Greenville's a city that's set up for it. Madcraft says Greenville's too close to Charlotte and Atlanta to pull that many. Cole is right. Charleston is more likely to see success, in my opinion.
Madcraft, we're right in the middle. We're right in the middle of two big markets that can both bring people from 2 hours away. We've got Charlotte, Columbia, Atlanta, Chattanooga, all within a 2.5 hour radius of us. Plus, we're the biggest city in this state. I don't get you people. And I'm going to say it, you people. Oh, it could never happen. Oh, we're just too small. Oh, there's no people. That's the reason why.
No, right it's there. Not.
That
no,
is the
it's
reason
not.
Why right there. You people saying like, oh, I'd really never be that into it because, well, it'll never happen.
So me saying it'll never happen is the reason.
Yes, exactly.
No, it's not.
Exactly.
I have no control.
Downers,
I have no control over it.
Excited about anything.
I have no control.
Good God.
So let me ask you this. If
what the hell is wrong with you?
So in your opinion, what you're saying is if I change my opinion and change my voice, all of a sudden it'll happen.
I didn't say that.
Yes, you just did.
I didn't say that.
You just said
it. I didn't say you, Cole Bryson.
You did.
Yourself.
You said you people.
I said all you people means collectively, okay? You people means
right?
It's Madcraft. It's you. It's
so we're the reason there's not a sports team here?
It's the thousands of people listening to the show right now all saying, well, it'll never happen because we're just not that attractive.
So we're the reason.
Have any money? Yeah.
Oh my word.
Yeah.
Oh my word. That's the craziest thing.
So what you're saying is if we had one billionaire in this city and literally no one else wanted it, then we would just have it.
It would help. Then it would help a lot more than me saying
okay.
Right?
Okay.
True or not?
I don't believe you.
So you're saying my voices matter.
People didn't want it.
My voice matters more than a billionaire's.
But we'll never have it because the will of the people doesn't want it.
But the will of the people is not what brought other sports teams to other cities.
It's called public momentum, Cole.
It's money.
It's called public momentum.
It's money. Diesel's fired up about it.
Says afternoon, you people.
Afternoon.
You got something to say about this? Text us 71307. Start your text with keyword fan.
All right, coming up at 3:45. Very next segment. If you're a baseball guy, you know how bad Angel Hernandez has been this past week. AAA baseball has a fix for this. Are you for or against robo-umps? Text the show, 71307. Phone lines also open as well, 844-FAN-PHONE. That's 844-326-3663. Find out what Diesel and I think about robo-umps in the MLB next, right here on the Fan Upstate.
baseball has been.
Your Namby Pamby sports takes at the door.
So I don't think that I ever thought, Diesel, I would be okay with changing a sport in such a way to where the umpires are not as involved as they are now. However, after I continue to see video clip of video clip after video clip of Angel Hernandez and other MLB officials who, for whatever reason, cannot get balls and strikes right, I think that I am more convinced than ever that I am ready for the AAA robo-umps to make their way up to the major leagues. Now, for those that don't know, the AAA is already using them. This, Diesel, is not 100% robot
it's
making
a tool.
It's a tool. That's exactly right. It's not 100% automated. It is a challenge system to where the umpire, who's still there, pats their head three times if they want to challenge what they saw. It happened a couple of months ago, early in the season when they were doing spring training. I love it. It's very efficient. You don't have players looking at the official like, what in the world was that? Diesel, I'll be honest with you, I like the purity of sports. I never thought I would say this, but I think it's time now for Major League Baseball to get robo-umps.
How is it that Rob Manfred has heard from fans for years?
Yeah.
For years, how terrible Angel Hernandez is.
God.
Yet they continue to employ him. And they continue to have him calling big games.
Union. That's the only reason.
I mean, God.
Seriously.
How great must it be? And there's probably a few in our listening audience who are like, yep, sounds like me. How great must it be to be awful at your job
mm-hmm.
or to genuinely not care about your job and just get to keep doing it
well,
at a high level for a whole lot of money when you're terrible at it?
I was told that the union has a ton to do with it. Apparently, Diesel, you can't get rid of guys in the union like you think. Evidently, firing an MLB umpire is a lot harder to do than people realize. I don't know why, but evidently
is this the Teamsters?
Evidently, they're part of some union to where it makes it complicated, too complicated to figure out. But I'll say this.
That's funny that the union has MLB by the short and curly.
They do.
There's nothing they can do when you have somebody who's terrible at their jobs.
No, it is sad. But, like, I love that the robo-umps are not there to completely control the game. But I do like that the fact that if the umpire wants to challenge, it's a quick 15-second process.
We have – I don't know how advanced this technology is. I'd imagine they're probably relatively close to maybe – making what I'm about to propose a reality. But I know that, like, I've seen Ray-Ban glasses that look like normal Ray-Ban sunglasses that have cameras in both sides.
Yeah.
Why couldn't they have a player profile that says this is so-and-so, he's 6'3",
mm-hmm.
his strike zone is this. And then the square, you know, like the rectangle that we all see when we're watching on TV.
Yeah.
Is just implanted on the umpire's heads-up display so that he can see right there through his glasses on a heads-up display whether or not this was a ball or a strike.
Our technology is way too advanced not to get it right, you know? Like, I still fuss.
I know. I think we love the subjectivity as much as we all claim that we hate,
yeah.
you know, not knowing if it was a touchdown.
Yeah.
Not knowing if the puck went, you know, across the line, not knowing if it was a ball or a strike. I think sure. we love it. Honestly, I think we do. we love the subjectivity. We love the chance to argue
yeah.
about stuff. And even if we know that it's getting it wrong, we're unwilling to do anything about it.
So what's interesting about this is this conversation is I've always said that our technology is too great for us to have these kind of yeah. mess ups. My biggest hurdle is in football, with all the technology that we have, Diesel, that we still rely on two fat guys with a chain to come out and see if the ball is past the first down marker or if it's past the end zone. Yeah. I hate that.
We're traditionalists, man. We love the pageantry and the spectacle and the silly, let's take 30 seconds and have two dudes wheeze their way across from the sidelines and stretch the thing out. Like, we love it. And here's the thing. We could still have that pageantry. We could still have the chain gang.
Yeah.
We could still have the umpire behind the plate making the final determination of a ball or a strike. But they should have the tools at their disposal to, again, show them a rectangle of what's a strike and what isn't.
Yeah.
Like, even have it go as far as when the ball comes in to the catcher's mitt, the camera is fast enough that it can track whether or not it went through this rectangle or caught a piece
yeah.
of this rectangle. And then it'll say, you know, whatever, green for a strike, red for a ball, something like that. That's all it needs to be able to do. And I don't know. Is that technology too advanced? Is it
no.
beyond where we our actual capabilities to put that into an umpire's heads-up display on his helmet or in his sunglasses?
What I like about the robo-umps is the fact that Diesel, if there's a call that is not correctly made, that the official, the umpire, can review it, but it's reviewed not by human but by the yeah. combination, right? Because when you and I are watching, just like we're watching now, the Braves Astros, when Max Fried throws a pitch at home, you and I can tell if that's a ball or a strike because of the square that you were talking about, right? That square is a great way for us viewers, I'm looking at it right now, to see whether it's a ball or a strike. There's no way we can't have the same technology on the back end because that square, it's either black or white. It's either a strike or it's not.
Yeah. I guess we just don't want the umpire taking a step back and essentially either not serving an actual purpose there or reacting to what the computer says
yeah.
just happened. Even though we know it's going to be more accurate, we know it's going to be right more often. And maybe it's one of those things that takes time. You know, it takes 5 years, and they've been testing it out in the AAA, so they've sure. already got this data started.
This is year two.
But you realize, Cole, like, you know, have you ever like try to log on to a website and it says, click every box that has a bicycle in it.
Yeah.
Or every box that has a street sign in it. You know, that doesn't actually have anything to do with you logging into that website. That's all to help build information for self-driving cars. So that self-driving cars can recognize what a street light is.
Really?
Technology's still got a long way to go.
Yeah.
And it's certainly far more crucial to get it right when you're talking about a car out on the road
mm-hmm.
versus a ball or a strike in a baseball game. But if we have the ability to analyze this much data with super high-speed cameras, why don't we have the ability to implement that, even if it's just offline, even if it's a tool, even if it's an aid?
I'm with you.
An ump can say, I don't know, that was close. Let me look at my little wrist display. And it says, oh, that was actually a ball.
And by the way, the Braves are now trailing, Diesel, before you send it to break. They are now trailing 3-2. Max is still on the mound in the fifth. The inning just ended. We'll see if he comes back out or not.
Long way to go in this one. When we come back, Cole, let's look at the NFL draft. We'll look at which NFL quarterbacks established on their teams are in danger of losing their starting job this year. That's next here on Wire to Wire. He's Cole Bryce and I'm Diesel, and we are the Fan of States. The first round of the NFL draft is now just 8 days away, Cole.
I'm ready.
We're very, very close to sitting and waiting another day to find out what the Carolina Panthers are going to do with the first pick of the second round. Hey, we're going to be live, by the way, if anybody hasn't heard. We're going to be live next Thursday from 3 to 7 at Dave & Buster's Woodruff Road in Greenville for our Fan Upstate Draft Special. We want to see you out there. We want you to help support the businesses that support us. That's how we get them to spend more money and support us more, is that when we come out, you come out. You support them, they support us. You see, it's like a circle. It just keeps going round and around and around of everybody helping each other out. Wouldn't that be just absolutely great? We want to see you out there next Thursday from 3 until 7. But, Cole, I wanted to look at some guys who are presumptive starters on their teams this year, some of which are just moving to a new team, some of which are entrenched on their teams and have been for a while, who very much are at risk of losing their starting job. There are a handful of quarterbacks in the league who are either starters and have been, or just moved to a team who very much look to be on the chopping block, who could be replaced. So I want to look at some of the teams who are presumed to be drafting quarterbacks in the first round of the draft. Everybody's draft board looks a little bit different. Everybody's got their opinion on who is going to do what and take who in the draft. But I think we all have a pretty good idea out there of who is likely to draft a quarterback. Obviously, the Chicago Bears are drafting a quarterback because they don't have one right now. Obviously, the Commanders are set to draft a quarterback. The Patriots are set to draft a quarterback. And after that, it gets a little bit fuzzy. You know, it gets a little bit curious what's going to happen with a couple of these teams. They've got maybe entrenched quarterbacks who haven't performed as well as expected. That happens. You know, 60% of guys in the first round are busts. Quarterback bust rate is higher than that. So let's go down the list here of teams that are expected to draft quarterbacks and who might be at risk of losing their jobs. Well, obviously, Justin Fields lost his starting job because he's probably going to sit behind Russell Wilson in Pittsburgh. I would have to assume that Russell Wilson wouldn't go without, you know, some sort of guarantee that he's going to be the starting quarterback. So there's one right there. That's an easy one. Justin Fields going to lose his starting job. Caleb Williams is going to be the new starter probably week one, and maybe even before that in the preseason there in Chicago. After that, though, this is when it gets really fun. So the Commanders have the second overall pick. They are currently lacking a strong starting quarterback option. Sam Howell, it was traded to the Seahawks. They traded for Marcus Mariota. He's been a starter in the league before, but it seems pretty clear that the Commanders are going to draft quarterback. It's probably going to be Jaden Daniels. Maybe they go somewhere else because maybe they like the option there somewhere just a little bit better. But, you know, Marcus Mariota, not an entrenched established starter in Washington, but he is probably going to lose his starting job as well. It's very unlikely that the Commanders would start anyone but Jaden Daniels. Now we go to New York. Go to the New York Giants, where Daniel Jones has just kind of continued to tread water. He's been okay at times. He's been bad at times. But the New York Giants, who currently hold, Cole, the number 6th overall pick, this is where it gets a little interesting. Some mocks have them going wide receiver and getting somebody to help out Daniel Jones. Some mock drafts have them potentially drafting his replacement. So it kind of depends on exactly where the Giants choose to go. They're mocked in one mock draft that I found to pick J.J. McCarthy out of Michigan. Do you think J.J. McCarthy is a strong enough candidate to start year one over Daniel Jones? I'm not super duper sold on that. But then again, if you're taking a quarterback in the top 10, it seems, you know, better chances than not, 51 to 49% chance that J.J. McCarthy very well may be replacing Daniel Jones at some point this season.
If they draft McCarthy, absolutely. Jones is done. Like, you can't draft in the first round and try to pretend like that, you know, this is the guy for the future. I do think we have to be careful a lot of times because J.J. McCarthy, for as good as he could be, you know, it spawns the whole question and debate of how long do you let a guy sit before they start? Or is a guy ready to start as soon as he comes into the NFL?
I like sitting a guy for a year.
Well, here's the problem with that.
That's not the modern style. That's not the way we do things.
The problem is you sit him for a year behind Daniel Jones. What is he going to learn from Daniel Jones? I don't know that.
He's not going to learn from Daniel. I mean, he will a little bit, but he's learning from the coaches. He's learning the system.
I just think that's a wasted year.
He's learning footwork.
I think that's a wasted year. If you go McCarthy.
It worked out real well for the Panthers.
With who?
With their quarterback.
What do you mean?
I don't know if you really don't know this, but Panthers quarterback didn't have a great season this year.
No, but I'm sorry, I'm confused.
Bryce Young.
What is that?
They put him in as a starter.
Yeah, but that's a lot different situation though.
Well, is it though?
Yeah.
Is it though? We're talking about putting a guy out there early before he's ready. That's what we're comparing. That's the apples to apples work we're comparing here.
But every situation's different, right?
Putting a guy out there early before he's ready.
So why is J.J. McCarthy not ready, in your opinion?
Because he's a rookie.
So Robert Griffin.
Very rarely are rookies ready to be starters in the NFL.
Yeah, I hear you, but my problem is I've seen Daniel Jones, and Daniel Jones has, you know, he's not promising. Last year he was absolutely pitiful. And if you're New York, you have to do something. And if you don't draft a quarterback and you do surround – kind of going back to what you said a minute ago, Diesel, if you decide to get a receiver, or if you if New York makes the mistake of putting someone else around him, well, guess what? That's their fault. Because if they're not at this point, if they're not smart enough to realize that Daniel Jones ain't it, that's their own problem. Yeah, because he's trash.
It's almost a foregone conclusion that they're going to draft quarterback there. I don't know that I look at J.J. McCarthy and say, hey, you are ready to take over my team in year one. I mean, Daniel Jones, you're right, was not great last year.
Yeah.
But Daniel Jones, at least as an experienced, mildly serviceable quarterback, to get you while you're getting J.J. McCarthy ready to go. So, I mean, I think if you have Daniel Jones, you don't have to put J.J. McCarthy out there as a rookie. And that's where a lot of these teams feel like they have to do that. They feel like they have to put a Bryce Young out there before he's ready. I don't know if you know this, Cole, but Andy Dalton, when he came in and played last year for the Carolina Panthers, when Bryce Young was down in, what, week four?
Mm-hmm.
He looked really good. Like, you didn't have to put Bryce Young out there. I mean, I know that trial by fire and reps in a live game are invaluable.
Yeah.
I understand that. But when you know, as the Carolina Panthers, that you have garbage on your offensive line, I don't think it's smart to put a quarterback out there who may not be ready as your starter in week one. I just don't think it's a smart move.
Well, I think it comes down to those two all summer in training camp and OTAs as they battle it out. Let's pretend like they do pick McCarthy, talking about New York. If McCarthy doesn't separate himself and he's struggling, yeah, you've got to roll with Jones, because Jones is, you know, to your point, he does have experience. However, you know, if McCarthy comes out and beats Jones out, regardless, Diesel, of if he's a rookie or not, I think that's when you feel like you have to put him out there, if he beats Jones out.
Yeah, moving on past that, we have, the Vikings, who their situation is a little up in the air. They just acquired Sam Darnold. Don't laugh. He was with the 49ers last year. They're mocked to pick Bo Nix. So Sam Darnold, a guy who has been a starter in the NFL, probably not going to be a starter for the Vikings. These are teams where I look at Daniel Jones and Sam Darnold as two very different quarterbacks. That's my point. I'm looking at, you know, it's easy to say that Sam Howell or Marcus Mariota are not going to be your guys. It's easy to say that, but it's also, I think, a little easier to look at Daniel Jones and say, all right, we've got Daniel Jones. We can trot him out there for one more year, or maybe half the season. Maybe if you start J.J. McCarthy or whoever it is you go after in week six, week seven, that's fine. But again, I look at it from an old school perspective of where you give your rookie quarterback time to learn, time to watch, and then you put him out there. And you're obviously from a newer school where you say you got no other choice.
Well,
you
I'm not saying that. I just think it depends on the situation. Like, if the situation, if you're learning from Aaron, from a guy like Aaron Rodgers or an Eli Manning or a Peyton Manning, I'm with you. I'm fine with a guy sitting a year. I'm not opposed to that. I have no issue with that. My issue is, I don't want to say my issue, but my emphasis, my point is, Diesel, I think it depends on the situation. And again, you know, if you go back to the Carolina Panthers situation with Bryce and Andy Dalton, I just think it depends on what kind of situation you're in. Every team is different in terms of what they have around them. I'm not always the guy that thinks you put him out there. If he can sit and learn behind a Hall of Famer, I'm all for it.
Okay, so let's go back down this list that we just had and look and see who's mocked to go where. And I want you to tell me if you think these quarterbacks will start on week one.
Okay.
Caleb Williams.
Yes.
Okay.
In see. Chicago, right?
Yes. Jaden Daniels, if he gets drafted by the Commanders.
You know, that's an interesting situation with Dan Quinn.
You feel better about Marcus Mariota than you feel about Daniel Jones.
No.
Marcus Mariota is currently QB1 on the roster there in Washington.
Well, I hadn't answered yet. I think that Daniels probably does start, because the reason what I was getting to is Dan Quinn just became the new head coach. They got a new coordinator. Got a lot of new pieces. Mm-hmm. I don't know that Dan Quinn is in a situation to wait. I think he's in win now mode, because they do have talent. He's done a really good job in the short time he's been there. I would know Diesel. I'd say that I think he does. I think Jaden Daniels, if he goes to Washington, I think he's starting over Mariota.
Okay. Let's look forward to the Patriots. Patriots, they're certainly in a position where they are going to be drafting a quarterback. They have essentially nobody at this point. They're also, it depends on, again, which mock draft you look at.
Sure.
But JJ McCarthy is mocked in one draft to go to the Patriots, which just feels like this is just Mac Jones all over again. I'm not looking at JJ McCarthy as that dude who's going to be elite at the next level, but you know, the Patriots, they're going to have to draft a quarterback. The Vikings are mocked to draft Bo Nix again, probably going to jump the shark and jump Sam Darnold and be the starter there in Minnesota.
So Sam's in Minnesota right now.
He's in Minnesota right now. They just acquired Sam Darnold.
I would not start Bo immediately over Sam.
Really?
No.
Are we talking about the same Sam Darnold here?
Yeah, I'd probably start to start the season. I'd probably start Sam Darnold. Again, I think a lot of it has to do with how does Bo look during training camp, right? If he goes out there and lights it up, obviously my opinion will be different. But I don't know that Bo Nix is I don't want to say I'm not sold on Bo, because I do like Bo. But you know, Sam's kind of, I don't want to say he's underrated, Diesel, but I think he probably does start.
Could you imagine the fan base there in Minnesota if they've got Bo Nix? And these fans have seen Sam Darnold everywhere he's been.
No,
he's a journeyman who's bounced from team to team to team to team. Mm-hmm. And they say, you know what? We're going to run out Sam Darnold.
Now, I'll say this. I don't think it would last long, because Sam's a serviceable game manager. That's what he is. I just don't know that they have the kahunas to start Bo.
I think you're being very generous with the word serviceable there.
Yeah, maybe so. Maybe so. I don't hate Sam Darnold. I don't hate him. He's just,
I mean,
you know, he is what he is.
All right, now look at the Raiders, who are mocked to draft Michael Penix Jr. Hmm. They've got Aiden O'Connell, his 2023 fourth round pick, and Gardner Minshew. I think that's another situation where you look and say, better chance than not, 85% chance Michael Penix Jr. is going to be the starter for the Raiders in 2024.
Yeah, right? Good chance. I don't know. You said Gardner Minshew and who else? Aiden McConnell?
Yeah, Aiden McConnell. Aiden O'Connell.
Aiden O'Connell. No, I probably agree with you on that. I think Penix would probably have a very good chance. And again, all this is subjective to what they do once they get there, right? But I do think that he would. I think he would probably beat those two out.
So there you go. Those are the teams that are expected to draft quarterbacks in the first round. Obviously, all of them have their big old question marks. Some of them have guys who have started in this league for a long, long time on their rosters already, who may actually never get a chance to be starters at those particular places.
Let me ask you this question.
Yeah.
Do you think that, because I heard you say this earlier, I'm just intrigued by this. Do you think Bryce would be better off if he wouldn't have named the starter last year and sat behind Andy Dalton? You think that would have helped him, or
yes.
You think so?
I do. I mean, Andy Dalton is not the same type of quarterback, even remotely the same type of quarterback that Bryce Young is. So, I mean, I understand if you're trying to install a new offense, if you're trying to change everything for Bryce Young,
yeah,
I understand why you may. I understand the logic behind starting him and not Andy Dalton. But when you know that you've got nobody who can protect your most valuable asset, but you keep throwing your most valuable asset out there anywhere, just taking grenades, then I don't think that's a smart move. I think you can learn just as much. Look, I mean, these guys were all great coming out of high school when they went off to college, but you know what they did at college? Most of them, they sat behind somebody else who already had experience. They learned the system. They learned the playbook. And then they were able to start. Then they became the best guy for the job. I don't understand why the logic changes once you get into the NFL. It shifts from let's put the best player out there to, well, we have to start this guy because he's our shiny new thing.
Yeah, I think that has a lot to do with it. And I think a lot of owners and general managers are so enamored with the win now mode that they have to feel like they have to win now, you know? And I'm not saying that it's the right move all the time, because I do think that sometimes, and I don't know where I stand on Bryce. I need to think about that. I think that's a very interesting question in terms of how he would be different if he didn't start last year. But I'm not always opposed to it. I'm really not.
And then we never got to this, Cole.
Yeah.
But a really interesting one that we can bring up later on in the show. Matt Stafford is old AF. He's mm-hmm. 36 years old. Had himself a fine 2023 season. But if the Rams choose to go quarterback, I think his time is short. It's running out. Not this year, but probably next year.
All right, coming up next, Jake Crain joins us right here on Wire to Wire. We have some very interesting questions for him. Coming up next, he's Diesel. I am Cole Bryson, and this is the Fan Upstate.
You can connect with us face-to-face next Thursday. We're going to be live at Dave & Buster's Woodruff Road in Greenville for our draft special. Want to see your faces out there. Want you to throw your support at them so that they will continue to support us. Speaking of support, I love supporting this guy's show. I love supporting this guy's work. He's one of my all-time current favorites of some of the biggest and best up-and-coming voices in sports. Jake Crain, host of Crain and Company. Find him on Twitter at @JakeCrain_. My man, I appreciate you jumping on the show with us and taking a little time this afternoon. How you living?
Dude, living great. First off, congrats, guys. Loving what I'm hearing. You guys are currently one of my favorites as well. So your check's in the mail for that one. But dude, David, I've never been to a Dave & Buster's. I feel like I need to go. I've never been to one.
I feel like you, of a lot of people that I know, Jake, would be distracted by bright, shining, and flashing lights. If that's you, then you're going to love it. Giant Mario Kart, you know, friends and enemies are made and lost right there on that game alone.
You had me at Giant Mario Kart. I mean, I'm like a fly to a light anyway, but you give me Giant Mario Kart and I'll see you in a couple months.
Jake, was it a bad look by the WNBA to essentially uninvite OutKick from their birthday party? Like, wouldn't it have been better to grant them their credential request and continue granting credential requests in the future, allow them to spend their money flying all over the country to send people to press conferences and then just never call on them? I think it was a small time look by the WNBA.
Well, I mean, you know, for an organization that needs as many eyeballs as humanly possible and is kind of caught lightning in a bottle, at least a little bit at the college level, with what we saw with the ratings with this past NCAA tournament. It just, the amount of stupidity never ceases to amaze me when it comes to really big organizations in general. But if they were really smart, they would actually engage in the conversation to drive more eyeballs to their sport. But they're not, because they want to censor out anything they don't agree with. And that's one of the reasons why this is just going to be a flash in the pan and not a buffet you can go to all the time.
Hey, I want to keep it on topic with the WNBA for a minute, Jake. I saw the interview earlier today with Caitlin Clark on the Pat McAfee Show, and I don't know why, but all the interviews I've seen with Caitlin, no one is asking her the one question that I want to know. And I want to ask you, in your opinion, when Caitlin Clark goes away from college basketball and the Angel Reese's of the world leave college basketball, do you feel like that college basketball is going to have a huge problem staring them in the face with trying to replace these stars?
Well, look, I mean, it's just like anything. It's like losing weight. The hard part isn't losing the weight. It's keeping it off. Now that they've garnered this attention, you are losing an absolute superstar who's going to have to take a pay cut in Caitlin Clark. And it wasn't just because of the way she played, but look at the controversies and kind of the villains that were created around her, and some could even consider her a villain herself. I think what made women's college basketball so intriguing, it's not just Caitlin Clark, that's a huge part of it, but you did have multiple teams that played about as high level of ball as you're going to see at the women's level. You know, it used to just be UConn beating everybody to death, and that got old and nobody wanted to watch that. Well, now you had Iowa, driven heavily by Caitlin Clark. You had South Carolina, you had LSU, you had USC with Juju there. So there were multiple teams that could give you good games and matchups. Losing Caitlin Clark is going to hurt on many levels. And again, it's not about reaching the top. It's about how do you sustain it. I think we will see a dip because you are losing kind of a generational eyeball getter in Caitlin Clark. Not that Paige Beckers is going to be fun to watch, that's true, but the amount of teams that can compete at a high level, I think are going to go back and take a dip. So I do think it's unsustainable. That's why all the hate that she's catching and banning people like OutKick is such a stupid move, because you're not striking while the iron's hot. You're actually striking people away while the iron's hot.
Jake, to follow up on that, why do you think so many major sports leagues struggle to generate new stars? I mean, you know, you look at a guy like Tiger Woods, he was certainly lightning in a bottle for his era and what he was able to accomplish. Caitlin Clark is another example of that. But once these players inevitably fall off as they age, we're seeing a lot of leagues really struggle to create new stars. Yes, Scottie Scheffler is a fantastic golfer, but he can't transcend the game the way that Tiger Woods did. I mean, is it just that there's no marketing budget big enough to create a star out of somebody who ultimately isn't the kind of star that they need?
Well, look, I think everything's cyclical, right? Like, you can only there's a reason that some of these athletes are termed generational, because they only come once or twice a generation. It's going to be hard for anybody to elevate the sport of golf the way that Tiger Woods did, because number one, he had the opportunity and he kind of had the backstory, right? When you look at Caitlin Clark and women's college basketball, it's a little bit of the same thing. It's being able to not only have that generational star, but hopefully that generational star creates more generational stars. The biggest thing is, it's just like the transfer portal. You can only operate with what the market bears, right? You can't go out there and try and create a star, because when you do that, most of the time they fall flat on their face. And it's not just about having stars, right? The NBA has stars, but as an organization, the NBA has alienated so many people politically that it's hard for them to market any star, because they have to fit in some pigeonhole narrative and believe certain things. That's why you just kind of have to hope, and when you do get those stars, you've got to be able to market them well. That's one thing that is, you know, been a big struggle for Major League Baseball, is that they have stars, they just don't know how to market them. That's one of the reasons I think Shohei Ohtani is going to slide on this betting thing, is because he's the Major League Baseball's golden hope to be able to market their game, not only here, but internationally. So again, it's just operating with the tools that you have. Some organizations do it better than others.
You can find him on Twitter at Jake Crain, that's C-R-A-I-N _. Did you ever think that you would be covering sports in a time, Jake, where we saw a NBA player banned from the game?
Well, I mean, banned from the game in general, nothing would surprise me when you see some of the off the field and on the court antics that we see. But as far as the gambling part of it, I didn't ever think sports gambling was going to be legalized like this. So I really didn't have that perspective. But when you think about it, I'm surprised, honestly, now that it hasn't happened more. But it does happen. They just go through third parties. It's just like, it's getting caught. Like, the way some of these guys are getting caught, you've got to be the dumbest person alive. It's like these people that are mega rich. It's like Patrick Mahomes' dad. Man, if you're going to get drunk, will you call an Uber? Your son's worth $1 trillion. Like Deshaun Watson. Dog, you're a star NFL quarterback. You don't got to go to Madame Kamei's palace. And even if you wanted to, where are all your friends at? Like, it just, at some point, it's just stupid, man.
Is the Jonte Porter story, Jake, proof that maybe Charlie Baker is right in his attempt to, you know, get rid of all player props in college athletics?
I think if you're going to let people gamble, you got to keep the player. People are going to find a way to go around the rules. Like, you're never going to stop that. They already tried that with prohibition, and look how that worked. I think you find the best way to regulate it, right? And then you have a deterrent like the NBA. You're banned for life, buddy. Pete Rose, you're banned for life. There is not a stronger deterrent than banning somebody for life. It's not changing the rules. It's putting together deterrents in place. The same thing with the bail laws. Well, if you arrest somebody and you let them out for bail, regardless, they're going to go back and commit more crimes. But if there's a strong deterrent, you're going to minimize the bad behavior. You'll never eliminate it, but you'll minimize it.
Jake, I'm not sure how big of a baseball guy you are, but I did want to switch gears here a little bit and bring up.
Oh, big. Played in college.
Well, now that's great, because you must love, if you played in college, you must love having guys like Angel Hernandez behind you. Are you okay with if we go ahead and bring this thing up from AAA to Major League and go ahead and implement RoboOps?
Yeah, just as long as there's a human being that we can argue with.
Yeah.
Right? Like, I don't want a coach having to go out there and try and fight C-3PO. Like, I want somebody in human form to be able to yell at and point at and scream at. As long as we have that, I'm fine. What I don't want is challenging pitches like they do in the minor league. We're already here all day, right? We're here 162 regular season games, 9 innings. We don't need to make it last longer. Angel Hernandez has got to have pictures of somebody in Major League Baseball.
Got to.
He's got to have pictures of – he had to Epstein somebody. He's got pictures of somebody doing something, because there's no way you can be this bad for this long without either being a troll or having some blackmail art on somebody.
Jake, I can't get a read these days on Deion Sanders. Is he the most liberal or the most conservative coach in college football? And I don't mean that in a political stance. I mean, you know, being player focused versus being, you know, NCAA and institution focused. He'll make flashy statements. He'll tell his players to get in the portal because you're not going to have a spot on this team. But then he'll also rip into his team for not going to class and making life hard on the professors. I can't figure out where this guy is, and in your mind, is that by design?
Well, I think Deion Sanders is where whatever's going to generate the most interest in what Deion Sanders is doing. Like, that's what he's going to say. I don't think he's worried about being a hypocrite. I mean, we see it all the time. You see in politics, just to play video, people say one thing when one person's in power, then somebody else in power, they'll say the exact opposite thing, knowing full well they're on video saying the exact opposite. So I don't think Deion Sanders has any shame. The problem now, though, is with the transfer portal. I thought Deion Sanders was bringing his Louis with him. Apparently, his luggage got checked and got lost somewhere in Saudi Arabia or something.
So, Jake, you piqued my interest. I did not know that you played college baseball. I apologize for that. So while Diesel was asking the question, I did do a little research, and I am going to read a quote here. I have a question. It's got to be answered right now.
Go ahead.
A quote from your college baseball coach at South Alabama.
Oh, God.
And it says, Jake's an outstanding young man. He worked hard this fall. He swung the bat well, but needs to improve his speed. So I have to know, did you ever improve your speed?
Man, I did. The problem was my rotator cuff in my shoulder and my labrum basically looks like a number three on the Arby's menu right now. Now, coming out of high school, man, I actually broke my foot my senior year and played the back half of my senior year basically having to take two Laura Tabs and drink a Gatorade and just try and make it through it. So I was never the fastest. You'll never confuse a crane with being fast, but it did improve. Too bad my shoulder looks like a roast beef and cheddar right now.
Jake, you know, judging from the video that Lane Kiffin posted that you retweeted from the Ole Miss spring game, I've never wanted to be a Labrador Retriever so much in my entire life. But what a life to be that dog. Who's jumping the shark in terms of spring games? Who's going way too far and turning it into just to a completely nonsensical event?
Well, I mean, Ole Miss. I mean, they did the most out-of-the-box thing, which I don't hate. Look, the spring game at the end of the day should be played against another opponent. I firmly believe that. There's only so much you're going to get out of an actual spring game. It's like the Senior Bowl. The practices matter way more than the spring game. I like it, but the first person who gets hurt doing a reverse windmill dunk and you're starting at safety for me, then we have a problem. But as far as the dog video, take that, PETA. How do you like that? Yeah, let me hear you now. Nobody lives, but like my dogs live better than 70% of the civilized world.
Jake, between your two co-hosts, David Cone and Blaine Crain, who's running the bases at full sprint and collapsing rounding third?
Oh, man. Well, you know, Blaine's still single, so he's the one who hits the gym the most. Cone's a father of three now, and they're all under three, so I don't think he'd make it past second.
He is Jake Crain at Jake Crain _. Look up his show, Crain and Company. It's on YouTube. It's on Spotify. It's everywhere you want to look for your sports content. Jake, man, we appreciate your continued support of the show and look forward to continuing to watch yours as well.
Always, guys, y'all are killing it. Always down to come on. And, yeah, come check us out. We have a good time. I'm the one in the middle that's the best looking and always right if there's any confusion.
Man, I'm just hoping that one of these days we get a cushy set like you have with the leather seats and the iPads. And, man, that's living right there.
Yeah, it is. The only problem is I sink throughout the leather chair throughout the show. So, like, I'm just slowly sinking. No, but it's a great setup. We have one of the best studios in the game.
Jake, I appreciate your time. Thank you so much for joining us.
All right, y'all be good.
Appreciate it. Thanks. That's Jake Crain at Jake Crain _. Man, if you like your sports with like a smidge of a right wing political leaning, then Jake's your dude, man. He's not gonna take it as far. That show doesn't take it quite as far as Outkick. That show's a little bit out there, all over the place. So that network is, but what Jake and Blaine and David do on Crain and Company, man, is just top-notch work. And if you like what we do, you're going to love what they do because, man, I'm going to be real with you. I rip a lot of stuff off from them. I learn from the best.
I like it. All right, Diesel does not know yet because I told him last night, or I put in the notes on the run sheet this morning at like 2 a.m., Diesel in red. Diesel, do not look this up because I'm going to have you guess what establishment was named the official bar and grill of the NFL. So, texters, please do us a favor and don't text in if you already know. I'm going to have Diesel guess the right answer. Maybe Diesel's banned from the looking at the text line for the next 5 minutes, but this, I've got to kick out of this. I want to see if
I won't cheat.
Yeah, don't cheat. I want to see if you are still a fan of this old fine establishment. He is Diesel. I'm Cole Bryson, and this is the Fan Upstate. Diesel, there are many, many really good bar and grills in the United States, right? Like, I don't know that there's anything better than going to your favorite bar and grill and getting chicken wings or whatever you may get. However, I did not expect the NFL, a classy group like the NFL, to name blank as the official bar and grill of the NFL. I'm going to give Diesel three guesses. And by the way, the Braves did tie it up. It's 4-4 now going into the ninth. Here we go. Diesel, three guesses. You have not seen this per se. This came out yesterday, late yesterday evening for the new 2024 NFL season. And I wasn't impressed because this bar and grill, I'm going to give you a little hint here. This bar and grill is not one that I go to, I would say, frequently or ever. So three choices that think nationwide. Mm-hmm. What bar and grill did the NFL name the official bar and grill?
First guesses would either be Raisins from South Park or Mulligans from Parks and Rec, but I don't think that's it. So I'm going to say guess number one. It's funny, Cole, you and I have to start thinking this way. We were thinking, oh, who might be advertising?
Don't look at the stream, by the way. Do not look at the stream.
Yeah. I don't have the messages up at all.
Good.
I got to start thinking like, all right, who's got the money to spend with the NFL? That's my,
was that AI over there?
Yeah, that was AI.
AI.
I'm going to guess like Hooters, because they're a nationwide chain and maybe they got some money to advertise.
Good guess. I would be more pleased if it were Hooters. However, you're incorrect. So you're wrong. You got two more guesses left.
Okay. Who else is nationwide? Who's got the kind of money that the NFL needs and would probably be in every NFL market?
The stream's going nuts right now.
Applebee's.
Bingo.
Yes.
You got it. You got it on the second guess.
Yes.
I'm impressed.
See, I told you, we got to start changing the way we think. You know, it's like small advertisers, maybe not have that kind of money. You got to find the ones who have a chain, who got money.
So Applebee's, evidently, people still eat there because
I haven't eaten at Applebee's.
That's what I'm saying.
Years.
That's what I'm saying.
Like an Applebee's is okay when you're on the road. You know, and you don't really know, like you're passing by a town, there's a good chance the Applebee's is probably going to be solid, you know?
Yeah.
Unless there's a Waffle House, in which case I'm always going to Waffle House over Applebee's.
100%.
there you go.
Applebee's. So the question is, my first question was, okay, evidently people still do go there if they have enough money to be the official bar and grill of the NFL. What is Applebee's even known for anymore? Like, when you think Applebee's, ooh, I don't even know. Like, what are they?
It's just kind of general Americana food, right? They got burgers. They got chicken sandwiches and tenders and wings.
Is it appetizers, maybe?
Yeah, appetizers. Yeah, they have been really – they've been hammering that on their advertising now for a couple of years.
That's what I was thinking, too.
Yeah, so it's more of like a redneck tapas restaurant.
Yeah.
You go in and you get a little of this, a little of that. You share it with your friends.
Cheap.
Cheap-ish. Is Applebee's even cheap anymore?
I don't know. I haven't been. But let me this is my point, though. I've never had a desire or craving to go to Applebee's. And again, maybe they've improved. I don't know. I just remember the last time I went, I wasn't impressed.
We have seen a big push over the past, it looks like, it seems like 10 years or so.
Yeah.
For a lot of the big box chain restaurants to go away. I mean, think just right here on Woodruff Road, we used to have a Chili's. It's gone.
Yeah. A lot of Chili's have gone. I don't know what happened.
A lot like the TGI Fridays, that type of restaurants.
I got another one for you.
They're all going away.
Fats.
Oh,
you remember Fats?
We had Fats right here next to the station.
No way.
Yeah. I used to love Fats.
They're done. Dunzo.
Completely done?
Completely.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
There's a YouTube channel I watch called Company Man. Not to blow him up or, you know, gas him up, but, He talks about companies and chains and stores that used to be huge that have really fallen off with the number of stores that they have. And it's fascinating to watch and figure out, like, why did this happen? And most of the time it's because a big conglomerate bought this company and then a big conglomerate bought that company and then quality just slipped and fell off.
We start talking restaurants and Diesel, you go to the stream.
34 new comments.
I'll go to text. Wow. Let me get these texts in and then I'll let you hit some of the stream. One texter says Applebee's is the most affordable for normal folk. Another Tolo says go to the Easily Applebee's on a Thursday night for dinner. You'll thank me later.
I have been to that Applebee's.
I have not.
More than once.
They are also known for cheap specials and deals mainly now. Another texter says Red Lobster filed for bankruptcy today. I didn't know that. 600 restaurants.
Really? With even with the Cheddar Bay biscuits,
that's
the only reason I go to a Red
they
Lobster.
They filed for bankruptcy?
I have never eaten lobster at a Red Lobster.
I hadn't either. The cheese biscuits you said are the best thing there. Amazon guy says Fats was garbage compared to Applebee's. I don't know if I can go with that. I don't know if I can ride with that. So a ton of takes coming in. What do you have on the stream? Anything worth reading on the stream?
Yeah, Trey says Ricky Bobby and his family would approve of Applebee's until Reese Bobby made a scene and stormed out. That's true, though. They did love Applebee's. And Stephen Webb says Applebee's quesadilla burger is great.
What is a quesadilla burger?
It's a burger with you. It's usually with some sort of like spicy cheese, onions and peppers and whatever other good stuff. You know, you think of from a Southwest food item, but it's wrapped in a quesadilla.
See, I hadn't had that.
They grill it. And it's all self-contained inside of the quesadilla. So there's no bun. You know, it's, hey, we're living in a world, man, where people are trying to get skinny. They're eating keto. They're eating less bread. Sure. And there you go. That's one way to accomplish it. I mean, then people
sounds
chase
good.
That down with a big old plate of fries and a sugary Coke. So it doesn't really help much.
Z Fink said he went through Applebee's for the first time in 15 years a month ago, and it looked exactly the same. Did somebody say that they used to work at Applebee's? On the stream?
I don't know, but Rob Brown says Applebee's is good as the lunch line.
Oh, like at school?
Is as good as, I don't know. Rob, what are you saying here?
Is he saying that it compares to the lunch line at school? Is that what he's saying? Because that's
Applebee's is better than that.
I don't know. That pizza on Wednesday was pretty good, Diesel.
Texas square says, piece. Spur Daddy says used to eat at O'Charlie's in Spartanburg a lot.
I did too.
But those are gone now. Yeah, man. It's like all those restaurants that got so big in the 90s and early 2000s are all going away.
What about that one, that Italian place in Tony Rama? You remember that? You ever heard of that? Tony Rama?
No.
I think they had one here. I could be wrong, but I think they did. I think it was a big chain. Maybe they didn't have one here. Maybe it was some.
I've stopped going to chains as much as I can.
Yeah.
Like I want to shop local, buy local, eat local as much as I can. You know, sometimes it's unavoidable. And a lot of times these places are not actually independently owned. They are owned by a big conglomerate that maybe they don't have 25 or 50 of the same restaurant, but they do own 25 or 50 restaurants that are kind of all over the place. Okay. Here it is. Applebee's is good as a punchline for jokes about where sad people hang out. Oh man, Rob.
Throwing
shade. You're throwing shade at Madcraft, who loves going to the Applebee's and Easley.
I swear though, JD said he worked at Copper River. I got you. I'm sorry. You still work there now? Is that where he still works? Because I do like Copper River. Let me know, Jake.
Copper River in years.
It's not bad.
It have been one time.
It's not bad. The potato soup at O'Charlie says Trey was the best. And then one texter said, all I need is Ryan's back. You remember Ryan's buffet?
I do. The Ryan's here on Woodruff Road got turned into a kind of a cheap, sketchy Asian.
Oh buffet. Yeah.
But I've it's still there. Ryan's on the inside, man.
It's same concept.
When I was a kid, Sagebrush was where it was at.
Sagebrush was good, man.
Shells on the floor. Loved that place.
So a lot of names of restaurants being thrown out. If you work at a restaurant or own a restaurant, hey, guess what? We can throw your name out there every freaking day. How about just call us and let's make it happen? Because we don't do this often, but we are given a lot of these. A lot of these restaurants aren't even in existence anymore.
Yeah, some we've thrown some shade, we've thrown some praise at them. A little of this.
So what do you think, NFL? We'll
salt, a little pepper.
NFL and Applebee's. You think they could have done better?
Could they have done better? Yeah,
I think Hooters would have been better.
Like I said, you got man, but the Hooters in Greenville has fallen off.
Has it?
Oh, it's not good.
The food or the
both?
Oh.
Both the food there has always been, you know, edible, but the talent is a different story. It's a different story altogether.
Oh,
but
like
I said, you got to find the restaurants that have national appeal. Because if you're trying to show a commercial in Green Bay, Wisconsin, for a restaurant that doesn't exist in Wisconsin.
That's true.
Doesn't mean anything to them. Doesn't mean anything to them. Hey, when we come back, it is time for Cole and I to disagree about everything, which we've pretty much done all day anyway, except for maybe the robo-umps thing. But we're going to talk about all of it next. We're going to put up our dukes. We're going to fight it out. The 5 o'clock fight happens just 7 minutes from right now. Atlanta Braves couldn't get it done in the top of the ninth. We are now in the bottom of the ninth, tied up 4-4 at Houston. 2-2 to Altuve.
This is huge.
Coming down to the wire, man. Look at those tens of people in the stands. There must be like a field trip day at the Astros Stadium.
Well, it's get out of town day for Atlanta. So it has to be. They have to play it early. But this is big. Let's see if they can get the sweep, man. I hope so. I hope so.
So every day at 5 o'clock, we do a thing called the 5 o'clock fight. It's three topics: sports, politics, otherwise, anything. We'll literally fight about anything. The rules are Cole and I have to disagree. We have to take different sides of the argument, and you tell us who wins each round. Here we go. Again, you are the judges. You decide who wins round by round and overall. We want you to text into the show, 71307. Start your text with keyword fan. Let us know who wins each round. You decide. We fight it out. And here we go with fight number one.
Round one, fight.
Cole, are you for or against robo-umps in Major League Baseball? They've already got them in AAA. Considering bringing them up, should they bring them up to the majors?
You know, after what I saw this past weekend with how bad Angel Hernandez is, I'm for him, man. Bring him on up, robo me up, AI me up, and have a guy out there in a lawn chair babysitting it to make sure it doesn't run away. But yeah, I'm for it. Let's do it.
Look, I don't hate robo-umps, but I'm against them because sports needs villains. And baseball is one sport that is just plain awful at allowing its players to have any kind of personality, to make stars out of them. We got to find somebody to hate. Might as well be Angel Hernandez's sorry ass.
He's terrible.
Just for the sake of having somebody to root against, I'm going to say I'm against robo-umps.
Madcraft says he is the old get off my lawn guy, and because of that, he says that you, Diesel, win round
really
one.
Finish my statement there. He's just like Diesel.
I like it, man.
Support Madcraft.
I want some consistency. I want these things to be called right. I hate sitting here and watching this crap of the Texas Rangers and the Astros and watching three straight balls, man. Like, come on, we're better than that. So I say, let's do it. Let's bring them on. Bring the umps. Bring the robots. I'm ready for them.
All right, next up.
Round two, fight.
Is it okay, Cole, to go out to eat right after you've just been to the grocery store? You go to the store, you get a buggy full of groceries, you bring it home, and you're like, nope. We go into the bar.
You go to the grocery store and spend $150 to $200.
Uh-huh.
And then you get home and say, oh, no, I don't want none of these groceries. I'm going out to eat. Are you kidding me? No, it's not okay. You just spent $100 to $200 at your favorite grocery store, hopefully Ingles. And when you get back, what did you go shopping for? I mean, what are you going to do with it? Eat it later? No, you've definitely... Once you do it, listen, wait a meal or a day, then you can go. But if you come home with groceries, you better have something in there pretty good.
Man, we do it all the time. My wife and I, we do it all the time. You finally have a refrigerator full of groceries, and then you say, I don't feel like it, man. It's hard work going on an app and ordering your groceries and then having it brought to your door because we're uber lazy. Like,
yeah,
sometimes we'll actually go to the store and pick up groceries that somebody else has already shopped for us, but very rarely anymore at all do we shop our own groceries. I know that's some bougie white people stuff, but that's what we do. And man, we get everything home. We're tired from playing Tetris in the fridge. And then we say, ugh, I don't even want any of this stuff anyway. And we go out anyway. It happens all the time.
It is bad though. It is. You just
do it. Yeah. You shouldn't do it, but you do it anyway. You know why? Because you're lazy and you're exhausted. And you're like, I don't want to cook. Not tonight. There you go. Who wins round two? You tell us on the text line, 71307. Start your text with keyword fan. And finally,
final round. Fight.
It seems inevitable, Cole, that college football players are going to become employees, whether it's the university, whether it's the conference, whether it's the league as a whole, we don't know. But if you're on contract and your scholarship is guaranteed, but the coach has got to cut you for performance, disciplinary issues, whatever it might be. So if you're cut from the football team, should the university still have to honor your academic side of your scholarship? Should they be allowed to stay on campus as a student if you're cut from the football team?
Unwillingly? Or is that include willingly as well?
I mean, I'm pretty sure you're never willingly.
Well, I'm saying so portal doesn't, this is just cut.
Yeah, I mean, assuming the portal's not an option.
Okay, only cut.
If you're on contracts, we're talking about 2, 3, 4 year contracts, you may be stuck there.
Okay, I got you. I'll say no. I don't think you should be allowed to stay on campus. I think you're cut, you're done.
Wow.
Adios.
You're just getting rid of all of it. I
clean the house, man.
Hey, both parties signed the contract, right? Both parties agreed that you're going to be on the football team. You're going to get this. You're going to get that. Education's going to be part of it. I think if you cut them from the football team, you still have to let them stay on campus, but you're going to have to make them pay. So you cut their scholarship to 50%. That way they still get some value out of the contract. You're not just screwing these kids over. But they don't get the full benefit of being a student athlete in good standing now.
It's a good question, though.
Yeah, it's going to be fascinating to see how this goes. I mean, you know, some kid could come on campus and sign a 4-year contract because he says, you know what, I'm committing to South Carolina. I'm going to be there for 4 years.
Yeah.
And then something happens and you got to cut them. Like, what do you do with them now? You both signed the contract. So there you go. That those are today's three issues. We fought it out. You tell us who won each round.
What do you want Diesel and Cole Bryson to fight about next?
If you've got an ass, I'll kick it.
Submit your topics to Diesel at thefanupstate.com.
Subject line, fight on the Fan Upstate.
Want to hear from you, want you to tell us what we should fight about next. You can email me, Diesel at thefanupstate.com. Just put the word fight in the subject line of your email. Tell us what you want us to fight about. Yeah, that's going to be really fascinating, Cole, to see what happens with players going forward. I mean, it feels like we're inevitably headed towards employment.
It needs to be, my opinion.
But what's going to happen if one day, you know, these student athletes band together and say, we're not really here to be students at all. We're here because we're athletes.
No,
we already know. We already know that's where they are, right?
Yeah.
A few of them do go get a degree. A few of them do pay attention in class.
Sure. Go to class.
But like, what happens when these student athletes sue and say, well, we didn't come here to major in school.
Yeah.
We came here to major in football. And everything you make me do that is not football takes away from my ability and my time to go earn extra money in NIL and endorsements and sponsorships. And it keeps me from being on the practice field or in the weight room training to get better as an athlete. I mean, we've watched every single one of the NCAA's tenets be struck down by lawsuits. What happens when these kids sue and say, well, we don't want to be students at all. We only want to be athletes.
Madcraft on the stream says Diesel with the win. A lot of text to get to as well. 71307. Start your text with the word fan. One texter says Cole wins round one for the comedic line of having a guy in the lawn chair, making sure the robot doesn't run away. Another texter, I don't want robo umps. I just want it to be right. Well, guess what, texter? Not to park on your text for a second, but that's kind of contradictory. Because if you don't want robo umps, you just want it to be right 100% of the time. That's proven that that can't happen. That can't happen. Another texter says, I like a correct call. I am with you. I agree. But we're not getting that, guys. Cole wins round two because Diesel doesn't support Instacart that JD does. I could deliver your groceries.
What are you talking about, man? I just said that we have groceries delivered to the house.
Yeah, he may have misheard you.
Yeah, you know, if we're talking 100 times or 10 times, we're probably getting it delivered to the house 6 out of 10 times. We get it shopped, and then we go pick it up maybe 3 out of those remaining times.
Yeah.
And then the one time we actually go shop it ourselves.
So I've never used Instacart before.
No? Oh, no. Dude, it's the future.
Mm-mm, never
it
have.
It really is. I mean, it's great. I'll bet you, they charge you, right? They charge you a fee to go shop your groceries for you.
Is it outrageous fee or no?
Depends on, I guess, who you shop with.
Does it depend on the total amount or is it a flat fee?
I don't know because my wife does that.
Okay.
But think about it this way. How many times do you walk down the aisles, hopefully at Ingles, and you're like, ooh, I want to grab some of that. Ooh, I want to grab that. You know, the impulse buys.
Especially when you're hungry.
Like you're spending $7-$8 on a fee to have somebody else go shop it for you, but you're also not buying $30 worth of additional things that you otherwise wouldn't have bought.
I guess that's good for people who are like disabled and stuff too.
Oh,
right?
It's fantastic for them, but it's also fantastic for really lazy people like me.
John Dog says, Robo umpires good. Eat what you bought. Absolutely not staying if you were cut. Cole wins. And then I like this text, Diesel. Round two, Cole. 5 kids in the house all playing multiple sports. You better believe the $600 we paid for the groceries this week, you're going to eat some of those groceries. Let's see. Texter 71307 started with the word fan. And since I'm a kiss ass, says a texter, I'm going to go with Cole with a clean sweep. Cole win tainted. All round, that says Gordon. I'm getting I'm actually getting some wins today for the first time in a while. Diesel, you said Uber though. LOL, I do Insta. Another texter, all good. Maybe I just missed you saying Instacart. Last text I see for now. Yeah, it depends on items and distance from store. It literally tells you where everything is in the store. Aisle 3 on right, 4 shelves high.
Oh, What does that mean? So he's saying that it tells you in the store exactly where to go to get the items that the person has ordered. So
whoever's
you don't
doing
have to find it. I mean, like, God, I would have loved to be a personal shopper for people when I was in high school and I worked at a grocery store.
Yeah.
Like that beats the hell out of going in the back and unloading a truck full of watermelons, getting all sweaty and hot with stinky busted open watermelons.
Sure.
That would have beat the hell out of doing that. Like, hey, you got an order, go get a cart front and go shop the store.
So I'll tell you this.
That would have been great.
So what you're saying is when you place the order through Instacart, whoever is doing your order, it tells them where to go.
I guess so.
Well, why don't they make an app? And they maybe already do. For someone like me who goes to the store and walks around 2 aisles for 10 minutes cluelessly because I can't find one thing.
Well, they have that at home improvement stores. Like if you are at Lowe's or Home Depot or whatever, you go on their website and you search the product you're looking for. And then it says, you know, go to aisle 34,
see, like
A12, and
Lowe's
boom,
or something.
Right there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I need that in a grocery store. I can't tell you how many times I'm walking around.
Man, these stores like shift their things around all the time and you can't find it. And then they've got like motor oil in the same aisle as,
well, let me
as
tell
wine.
You,
it doesn't make any sense.
The Ingles near my house right now is completely renovating the entire store.
Oh, you're lucky.
Well, I am, but like that means that everything right now is just
true.
You want to go find fruit, you have to go to the bathroom, right? If you want to go find, you know, water, you have to go to the produce. It's wild and wacky. What about this message, Diesel, on the stream from Russell? Once players become employers of a university, what would stop them from sticking around after their senior year? What would stop college football from starting to compete with the NFL?
Well, the terms of the contract. I mean, they could always change the number of years of eligibility that you have. So,
Braves just took the lead.
Arcia with the RBI. Was that a Ooh. Fly to center field or something?
No, it's just a base hit over to left field. And finally, Ozuna. That was not Ozuna. I'm sorry. That was Arcia. He knocked one in for Atlanta. So there Atlanta has a 5-4 lead.
5-4 lead, top of the 10th.
Let's go.
Top of the 10th. Let's see. Yeah, what's to stop them from sticking around? Again, it's an agreed-upon amount of eligibility that you have. I mean,
yeah.
What's to stop anything from happening once the NCAA finally just takes their hands off the wheel and says, I'm done? I mean, it's crazy that we still have players, you know, picking up another year of like COVID eligibility. And I just saw something across my phone a little while ago about the NCAA changing its rules on the number of times you can transfer. I think this had been talked about, this had been floated, but I think it now finally became became real. Okay, here it is. From Heather Dinich, this came out at 3:28 this afternoon, so it gave me a little bit of a late notification. The NCAA approves new transfer rule allowing immediate eligibility. A new NCAA transfer rule will allow all undergraduate athletes to transfer and play immediately if they meet specific academic requirements, as the Division I Council on Wednesday approved emergency legislation announced by the NCAA. So there you go. There's no one-time transfer, and after that, you got to sit out. No, you can transfer as many times as you want. So these guys can play for up to four schools over the course of their career. Is that really where we want this game to go? Well, it doesn't matter because we're there, and the NCAA doesn't have the stones or the money to fight any of these things anymore. Again, I've never seen an organization have their rules be systematically dismantled like this so quickly.
It's a good question. I think it's going to go there eventually. I just, you know, it might be a while. Darno's at the plate right now. He's 0-3 on the day. Atlanta still does have two runners on base here in the top of the 10th with two outs. So hopefully Darno can get a little insurance. Ah, just kidding. Oh, my God. Please watch this replay. This is absolutely unreal. That was not even anywhere close. Of course, they're showing a freaking pizza commercial. That was not a strike.
They're not even going to give you time to look at it and think about it. They're just going to move on. That's like the refs in football when they make a terrible call at the end of the game and they just sprint off the field. Sorry, we're not even going to take the time to look at this. We getting the H out of here.
That was unreal. I hate that crap. All right, coming up next. My reaction to both play-in games last night, I did stay up to watch the second game. The first game came on at 7:30. Lakers game, no problem. But the second game did hurt my sleep schedule, Kings and Warriors. So I have a couple of questions. Number one, is the Warriors dynasty over as we see it? Also, number two, I'm a big LeBron fan, but I love what I saw from Zion last night. Zion, 4 years into his career, is it too late for Zion to be the next guy in the NBA? We'll talk about it. He's Diesel. I am Cole Bryson. We appreciate you joining us on Wire to Wire right here on the Fan Upstate. So last night, I did stay up to watch both NBA games. I thought the first one was better than the second one. By the way, the Atlanta Braves just turned a double play to sweep the Houston Astros in 10 innings today. Freaking incredible performance. Braves are
ass in Astros.
Yeah, they're putting a little good play together here, man. How about it? I love it. Big win today for the Bravos. Three game sweep in Houston. Not the easiest thing to do, but a big win. So going back to last night, I have a ton of thoughts because I love the NBA and I love the NBA playoffs. And what we saw last night was so interesting with Golden State losing. That's one of the questions that I have. And I want to start there. We'll get to Zion. We'll get to what happened in the Lakers game. But Golden State, Diesel, is probably, for those that follow and love sports, probably one of the greatest dynasties that they can think of in their lifetime. Obviously, what Tom Brady did, it's hard to compare. But what Golden State's done, in their prime years, and even when they went and got KD, it's something that will never be replicated again. So I asked the question, is the Golden State dynasty officially over? Here's what Chuck had to say last night on Klay Thompson's future with the Warriors. And I don't necessarily agree with a lot of this stuff I'm hearing.
Serious trouble because number one, Draymond's got three or four more years. They're gonna have to make a hard decision on Klay. Klay's not gonna get younger. Do you sign him for three or four more years, which he won't? That's the elephant in the room. Because they got to make a decision on him. And listen, we all love Klay, and Klay wants a max deal. He's not gonna get a max deal, but you see he's compromised because of the ACL and the Achilles. Do you still sign him for three or four more years what he wants? How can you get young if you're going to sign him? So they are in serious. I just asked, what would
you... So I'm going to fade that audio out, and then I'm also now going to play Steph Curry audio from after the game on how he envisions this going. Because I have really strong feelings on this. I'm just not so sold that we should be trying to put all of our eggs in the basket on keeping these three together. Here's Steph.
I can never see myself, not with those two guys. I understand this league changes and there's so many things that go into it and we're not going to play forever, but, we've experienced so much together and at the end of the day, like, again, I know they want to win. I know I want to win. And that's all I worry. That's all I'm worried about.
Diesel, here's where I have a problem. All roads do come to an end, right? Even in sports. You and I both know that. I have an issue with trying to keep these three together, Draymond, Steph, and Klay, when, number one, they're clearly out of their prime. Number two, time has passed them by. And number three, they don't have the same team that they had 5 years ago.
Well, you're also trying to augment Steph, Klay, and Draymond with guys like Chris Paul, who are also past their prime.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess there's value in riding with what you've got for as long as you can.
Ugh.
But, like, at what point does the ownership of the Warriors look at themselves and say, man, we are old.
Mm-hmm.
We are AARP as far as our roster goes. We've got to get younger if we want to be able to keep this up. I mean, take some pressure off Steph. Take some pressure off Klay. Get some younger players in here who can be really good and let them stay out around the arc and shoot.
I don't know what it benefits you. If the organization decides to keep these three together, and obviously Klay, as of right now, is a free agent because their season came to an end, and Klay Thompson's a free agent. So, I get it. I get the whole thing of Diesel, what those three did for the organization was so incredible. It'll never be replicated. But at the same time, man, like Tom Brady and Bill Belichick didn't last forever. The great dynasties don't last forever. At some point, you have to break them up. Golden State has pieces. Like, they're going to ruin their chance of being competitive if they stick with these three old guys.
It's like they want this to be, an old Western where Everybody just rides off into the sunset. You get that nice, wasn't that nice conclusion
yeah.
to the story. And that's just not going to happen.
Unless they retire.
Yeah, unless they all choose to retire together at the same time, which, I mean, it would be unprecedented.
But
like,
holy crap.
I mean, would Clay look at this and want to be, you know, and want to pull a Scottie Pippen and say, hey, what can I do without Michael? What can I do without Steph? If I'm the man, if it is 100% on my shoulders, instead of splitting the weight and carrying the load with Steph,
yeah.
what if it was on me? Could I be that guy?
At this point in his career, no. You're right.
The same thing happened with Kyrie and LeBron.
Yeah.
Kyrie thought, hey, I'm good enough to be a number one by myself. And he wasn't. And he's been chasing it ever since.
I think with these three, they are each good enough in their prime to go somewhere else and carry a team. However, today they're not good enough to do that. And I think that's why you have to recognize, as Steph said, it is a business. I don't think there's any way, Diesel, next year these three are back together. I wish so badly that Steph would follow in his father's footsteps and come to Charlotte and retire a Hornet. Because, number one, it'd give us a reason to absolutely follow Hornets basketball.
Might be the only thing that gets a spark going in Charlotte.
Sure, sell tickets. That's what I think Steph should do. It'll never happen, but that's what he should do. He should follow in his papa's footsteps and retire a Hornet, man. That'd be great.
Would you really want to end your career at one of the worst teams in the league?
Don't ask me that question. Don't ask me that.
No, I'm asking that.
For how much money?
How much money would you have to need to get paid to whore yourself out for a team that has no chance whatsoever of even making the playoffs?
If I could get a couple pieces with me, I might. If I could get, you know, a couple of young guys to come play me and maybe try to go after, you know, a playoff run or something. You never know what could happen. But to put a bow on the Golden State conversation before we get to Zion, I do think that we all who love the NBA appreciate what they did.
Sure.
I just think it's time for it to end. I really do. I think it's time to hang it up. I think it's time for Draymond to retire.
Well, how much longer do they get to hold that franchise hostage?
That's what I'm saying. Clay's just not – I'll tell you this. I know Clay's battled a lot of injuries, but Clay's not even close to remotely close to the player that he used to be. Draymond, I'm done with Draymond because of his antics.
It almost feels like he's finding ways to get kicked out of games, daring Adam Silver to pull the plug on him and say you're done.
Exactly. All right, so that happened in the second game. The Kings beat the Warriors. Warrior season's over. Probably the end of the Curry dynasty. End of the Warriors dynasty, right? The second piece of this last night, Zion Williamson, who I've always wanted to have a good career in the NBA. Covered him in high school, watched him play a lot of games right here in the upstate. Just the first 4 years, he wasn't the absolute best. Now, this year, however, he's dropped some weight, and he's had a really good year. My question becomes, Diesel, here he is in year four. He's done for the season. We saw that tweet, right? He's not going to come back unless they were to win, and maybe down the road he comes back. Yes. Which I don't see happening.
The Pelicans without Zion are not beaten.
No. Well, they're not beaten. The Kings.
Excuse me. Got that wrong.
Kings. So
it was L.A. My apologies.
So my point is with Zion now in his fourth year, can he still get to a point, Diesel, and the audience, to where he does take over as the face of the league? Because the reality of it is, you and I talked about this a couple of weeks ago, Diesel, with LeBron. LeBron's time's coming to an end. It is. We don't know how long, but it's coming to an end. Within 1 to 2 years, I think. Whenever that happens, there's going to be a huge, huge hole in the NBA because of LeBron's ability to play at such a high level for a long time. Somebody's going to have to fill it. And there are plenty of talented players in the NBA. But coming out of high school, Zion was talked about of being – he was talked about, Diesel, and likes of being the next guy.
Yeah.
So here he is in year four. Looks like his year four might be done because of the hamstring injury. But I guess my question is there still hope to have Zion as the face of the league?
Oof. I mean, I don't know that Victor Wembanyama is the kind of guy that will garner that kind of national attention. Now, we were talking about with golf, the guy that's a star inside the game versus the guy that's a star outside of the game. Victor is absolutely going to be a star inside the game.
Yeah.
Can he transcend it and take it to new places? I don't know. I mean, Zion, my fear for Zion is it has nothing to do with like any kind of negative sentiment that he's built up to this point, because the majority of people, if he all of a sudden started showing up on Wheaties boxes and in car commercials, they'd be like, hey, who's this new guy, Zion Williamson? Most people are probably not going to know him. But my fear is that the cumulative damage that he's done to his body by carrying too much weight over the past 4 years will shorten his career significantly. I mean, had he stayed in tip-top physical condition for 4 years, he wouldn't have the small little micro tears and this issue and this strain and this thing that's going to, you know, accumulate over time. So I don't know that Zion's going to be that guy who has a 20-year career in the league, a la LeBron James.
He may not.
You know, he may only be in his prime for like 3 seasons.
God, I hope not. But I'm not disagreeing with you. A couple of stats I have. Before I get to those stats, I want to get to this. A couple of texts. One texter says, if I had a wager, a guess, I would say the Warriors keep only Curry and try to surround him with more skill so he can be a primary shooter. I like that text a lot. Another Tolo says, there's no way it's smart business move to keep all three because Draymond is suspended way too much and Klay isn't what he was. Agree with that. And then the last text that I see for now says, I'm skeptical on Zion only because he can't seem to escape injuries. As you were just talking about Diesel, he definitely has the talent, ability, and star power if he can stay healthy. Real quick before the break, here's some interesting numbers. Zion versus LeBron, year 1, 2, 3, and 4. I pulled this last night thinking, surely LeBron was a much farther ahead, right? All right, year 1, Zion played 24 games, LeBron played 79. Year 1, LeBron played obviously a lot more games, right? Year 2, Zion played 61 games, LeBron played 80. In year 2, Diesel, Zion averaged 27 points per game, LeBron averaged 27 points per game. Year 3, Zion played 29 games, LeBron played 79. Zion averaged 26 points per game, LeBron averaged 31. So LeBron's obviously played.
Started out pace.
Yes. Year four, where it does get interesting. And this is where I like to see if this continues over year 5 and 6 and 7, comparing the two. Year 4, Zion played 70. LeBron played 78 this regular season. Zion averaged 22. LeBron averaged 27. Zion did shoot the ball at a higher clip, better field goal percentage. Statistically, when Zion plays the amount of games that LeBron does, their stats, Diesel, aren't terribly far off.
Sure. Five or six points a game.
Yeah.
I mean, I think he has the ability to be a next face, but I don't think he'll be the next face. I mean, look, there's always new guys coming to the league trying to usurp and be the next guy, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I fear for Zion that the game will pass him by.
So I hate to say this because I do love Zion, but I agree. I don't think Zion living people. It's the same thing we do with Tiger Woods, Diesel, living up to LeBron, Michael's standards. It's a generational type player. Probably would never happen again. He could be a face. He could be a face in the league. I do agree with that. But being what LeBron was and being the face, I hate to say it, I just don't see it. Yeah, I really don't.
Unless he really picks up his desire to be in front of everybody everywhere all the time and they make a star out of him, I don't know that he'll really ever achieve that. Cole, we have mentioned this a couple times on the show so far. We haven't really fleshed it out to this point, but man, we have just seen an NBA player banned for life.
Wow.
For gambling. What exactly happened? We'll talk about that next here on Wire to Wire. He's Cole Bryce and I'm Diesel. We are the Fan Upstate. We are Wire to Wire. I'm Diesel. He's Cole Bryson. We'll be live on the road next week. Two different chances for you to come see us. We'd love for you to come out to both. Next Wednesday, we'll be live in Piedmont at Ingles Markets. We want to see you out there. Support Ingles because we love all the support that they give to us. And on Thursday, we're going to be live at Dave and Buster's Woodruff Road in Greenville for our draft special. We'll both be there. We want to see you decked out in your gear. You know, whatever team you support, come on out and show.
I'm a deck
show guy. Dave and Buster's. Are you?
Yeah.
You got like special sunglasses. You got a suit with your favorite team, with your Cowboys logo all over it. Can we get Cole to get his Dallas Cowboy tattoo live on the air?
Wow.
Out on the draft special. You said you wanted one right there on the small of your back.
That would be incredible for it to be live. The pain that y'all would get to experience.
I don't know if they would allow that in the restaurant.
But
that'd be rad to see if we could do it.
Do they have mobile tattoo artists? Is that a thing?
Help us out. The chat on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter.
Surely so, right?
Help us out.
If not, might not be a bad business idea.
There you go. Yeah, well, you want to do it stationary. You don't want to do it mobile.
I will be decked out. I'll be decked out Thursday. I'll be there.
Texter says if Ja Morant stops carrying a gun, he could be the next guy too. Another
Texter, come on.
We throw come on at Ja.
He's Morant. Right though.
I didn't realize that Ja was short for dumbass.
Yeah, it's JA, not DA.
Yeah, speaking of more dumbasses from JA to JP, Jontay Porter is being given a lifetime ban from the NBA. For violating the league's gambling policy. The NBA says that he disclosed confidential information to sports bettors and limited his own participation in one or more games for betting purposes. According to the league's investigation, he bet the Raptors to lose. By the way, this segment brought to you by FanDuel. That's bad, man. He bet his team to lose and then limited his play. Like, was he that good of a player?
So he never bet on games that he played in, but he did bet on his team. The smallest bet he placed.
To lose.
Correct.
And then he limited his time in those games.
The smallest bet was a $15 bet. The largest bet, Diesel, $22,000 bet.
Well, who are you? Why do you have such range in your bets?
His net winnings?
Are you a high roller or are you not? Career stat.
Net winnings, by the way, $21,000 worth of net winnings. Diesel and I both are chomping down on cough drops day. Yeah. It's that time of year. If you can see the
he's not a great player. I mean, career stats, he averaged 3.7 points a game, 2.6 rebounds.
Now, you gave it to me.
Free throw shooter, but like 40% when you're only scoring 4 points a game, which means you did what? You took three shots, six shots,
and you hit two of them. That's so dumb.
Three of them. Come on, dude.
Like, you had a really good career. You were playing basketball for a living.
Yeah.
And you're going to throw it away. I want to see what his salary was. He was making this year. Oh, wow. He made, he came out, I think he made 2.3 this year. So,
yep,
not a bad career there, Bubba. All thrown down the drain.
You threw away a $2.5 million career. Compare that to, or $2.5 million salary. Compare that to the $150,000-$200,000 salaries in the WNBA.
Yeah,
and this guy is making 10 times that much, and he's throwing it away on like $15 bets.
Can you remember in your lifetime a lifetime ban other than Pete Rose? Like, this is the first one I can remember.
Yeah, but the difference is Pete Rose was betting on his team to win. Like, Pete Rose would set a high over and then go chase it.
Yeah.
And try to get it. So, like, I mean,
this is unbelievable, hey, man.
There's a dumbass born every day.
You know what, though? And this is terrible that this is what I think about. But I'll tell you what, this is the reality of it. Jontay Porter banned from the NBA for gambling on his team. I think the first thing that comes to my mind, Diesel, is who's retired now or maybe at the end of their career that didn't get caught.
Ooh, there's probably quite a few.
There's got
to
be.
There's got to be. I mean, you look, you, it makes sense to wager on what you know.
Right? Sure.
And you know basketball because you're there every day. You've got inside knowledge. I mean, we brought this up in our chat with Jake Crain earlier, which you're going to hear played back in the 6 o'clock hour of the show today.
Yeah.
You know, why wouldn't you gamble on what you know?
Yeah, makes a lot of sense.
You've got inside information on your teammates. You've got intimate knowledge of your own team, and these guys all talk to each other. You know, they've got friends on other teams. They talk to each other. What's to stop them? You know, and like, it's always the idiots who get caught in the dumbest way possible, right? It's they're using their regular cell phone that's not password protected. They're not using any kind of a VPN.
Yeah.
Masks where they are.
Well, his brother's really good, though. That's what's interesting. Hopefully his brother is not a gambler who plays for the Denver Nuggets.
Yeah.
Michael Porter Jr., one of their best shooters. This is fascinating on so many levels, Diesel, but you know what it comes down to, man, is
there's a dumbass born every day.
There is. There really is. And
who was that kid who he was a big name player who got arrested on an international trip in China stealing in China?
Oh, I remember that.
Remember this?
Yeah. I do. I just can't think of who it was.
Donald Trump ended up having to go get him out of Chinese jail.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just like, dude, you've probably been warned.
Yeah.
100 times.
But, you know, this came out. I don't know if you remember or not. When the day we were talking about Ohtani, as soon as the show started, this came out like the same day.
Yeah.
And here they are all of a sudden now.
They're not going to ban Ohtani because he's the golden boy. Dante Porter is a bannable guy.
Oh, without a doubt. You average 3.3 points per game. Many, yeah, ban him.
How many non-bannable guys are there, do you think? In the NBA,
Lot.
Would they not ban? Like, let's just say any one of the top stars got caught doing exactly this, they wouldn't ban LeBron. They wouldn't ban Steph.
How many? There's probably
they'd ban the hell out of Draymond.
Yeah, probably so.
They wouldn't ban Kyrie. They wouldn't ban Victor.
There's probably 25 Diesel that it wouldn't ban.
Yeah,
on the unbannable list, the same list that Shohei's on. One texter says, I have absolutely no problem with players betting on themselves or on their teams to win or go over. Well, texter, you may not have a problem with it, but it's
the leagues do. The leagues have a big problem with it.
That is insane, man. Like,
because it's called colluding.
Yeah.
It's called cheating. If you have inside knowledge, that's like saying I have no problem with a CEO selling off all of his stock right before he knows that something crazy is going to happen. That's called insider trading, Texter. This is insider trading of information used to place bets.
Well, you
it's
know
the same thing.
You know what the good news about this whole situation is now?
We got one less dumbass in the
league. Well, besides that, now that he's out of the league, he can gamble as much as he wants.
Yeah.
Can he?
You said he won, what, $2 million?
Oh, no. His winning wages were only $21,000.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
So we know that you said he bet a bet as big as $22,000 before.
Yeah, total wagers, $54,000.
So he's losing a lot more than he's winning. I don't think he can make a career out of being a gambler. I mean, when you've won half of what you've bet, you're not a very good gambler.
You're not wrong, but it is terrible.
Red Foreman would have something to say about it.
All right, coming up next, the biggest news of the day, maybe the week, maybe the month, for South Carolina Gamecocks. If you just got off work and you missed it, South Carolina Gamecocks, today, what a day for you. We'll tell you why. Coming up next, he's Diesel. I'm Cole Bryson, and this is the Fan Upstate. an absolute ton to get to in terms of our headlines, but we don't call them headlines. We call them Daily Wires right here on Wire to Wire. He's Diesel. I'm Cole Bryson. We appreciate you being a part of the program as we are going to hit all of these wires. The biggest wire, though, Diesel, the one that's the most important. Ooh, did you see my hair stand up when you did that?
Did it really?
I think it did. That was electric, man. That was electric. The biggest wire of them all, Lamont Paris. He said, yeah, I may be in year three, but I'm going to go get, once again, the number one prospect, the number one recruit in the state of South Carolina, and Cam Scott. What a huge, massive pickup. We're going to get back to it, but your instant reaction when you saw that this morning.
He is running circles around Brad Brunell when it comes to recruiting the state of South Carolina.
Yeah.
I mean, PJ Hall was great, but that was 4 years ago, Brad. What else you got, man? You are not showing the ability to get the best guys out of South Carolina to choose Clemson. You have the longevity. You've been there 13 years, but you're letting a guy who's been around for a cup of coffee make you look bad.
The reality of it is Columbia has always been an area that puts out basketball products. Columbia, if you ever follow high school basketball, really good high school basketball. They always put out good products. So Lamont Paris, what he's doing there is not like some, in my opinion, some a grand extraordinaire. He's just keeping his kids home, you know, and that's what he should be doing. So we'll get back to that.
And you get to the point where you can select players.
Yeah.
And you can pick the best ones and keep them nearby. That's as good as you can hope for at a time like this when guys are just all over the place and they're not committing for any reason other than cash.
Other Daily Wires, the Lakers defeated the Pelicans last night in the Western Conference play-in 110-106. Zion went out with 3 minutes remaining in the game and did not come back. That was brutal. He had 40 points. And as Diesel said earlier, Wojbomb reported that Zion's out for Thursday's play-in game as well. And that's tough. That's really, really tough for those Pelicans.
Hoping that he can get back. I mean, if the team can somehow find a way to lift themselves past the Kings, hopefully he'll be back for the playoffs.
You'd hope so, man. You'd hope so. It was a weird injury. He just came down on it wrong and went straight to the locker room. Speaking of the Kings, they took down Golden State last night, 118-94. The Braves, guess what they just did today? They just won in 10 innings, 5-4. How about those Atlanta Braves today? A clean sweep of the cheating Houston Astros.
A lot of late inning wins and heroics for this team this year. We saw it on Sunday on the last day of the Masters. They needed a home run to lift themselves and win that game on Sunday. So, hey, you know, a team that is hampered right now by the injury bug.
Yeah.
Strider out.
Sean Murphy,
second baseman is out as well.
Yep.
You know, you got to be able to find ways to win games and keep the ship afloat now so that hopefully when you get these pieces back, you know, Strider not being one of them.
Yeah.
But when you start getting pieces back, then maybe you can, you know, kind of pick back up where you left off and still be in playoff contention.
Well, and to your point, it is a really good sign. The Atlanta Braves have this year shown that they can win in a few different ways. It's still super early in the year. We're like 0.8% in, so we're not even to a tenth of the way in yet. The MLB season's so long. We're still in the baby phases, right? But the Braves are 12-5, man. They're 12-5, and they're 2.5 games up in the National League East right now. The Mets and the Phillies, I believe, are tied for second, which they are, and then the Nationals and Marlins are both below 500. So a division that we'll see. We thought it would be Atlanta and Philadelphia, but New York, you know, they started off horrible. They've won a few games since. We'll see if they can be consistent down the stretch, but should be really interesting. Ozzie Albies, Diesel mentioned it, placed on the 15-day IL. Atlanta, Houston, that series is over, so that's new old news. Clemson baseball won last night. They defeated Charlotte by a score of 8-5, so the Tigers are now winners of two straight after losing 3 of 4. The Tigers are now 30-6 on the season, so a big win for Clemson last night for their midweek. South Carolina baseball They also had a win last night over the Citadel, 4-3. Citadel, they're having a really rough year. Gamecocks improved to 26-11 on the season. And all of a sudden, Diesel, they've won five of their last six. So, boy, oh boy, how things can change quickly in the game of baseball.
Yeah, that's true. A lot of people were already writing off this South Carolina baseball team,
thinking,
oh, here we go, just another mediocre season for Mark Kingston and company. And they were looking at this as, hey, maybe this is our chance. Maybe this is when we finally get rid of the guy. But nope. He's on himself a little bit of a heater. I mean, the schedule never lets up, right?
Did you say Mark Brownell? Is that what you said?
No, I said Mark Kingston. No,
but I'm saying they both kind of similar there.
I see what you did there. I mean, Gamecock fans are looking for any reason to move on from Mark Kingston and get in Ray Tanner's ear and try to force him out. I mean, these are the reasons why Ray Tanner won't do it, right? Because just when you think things are going the wrong direction, you think things are getting a little bit squirrely, he pulls the car back onto the road.
Brad Kingston.
Mark Brownell.
We're terrible.
Separated at birth.
We are awful, man. That's just pitiful. But you're right. Listen, 1-5 of the last six, we'll see. They have a really tough one coming up against Arkansas this weekend, number two team in the country. That'll be tough. Tonight's Eastern Conference play-in games, Miami at Philadelphia, Atlanta at Chicago. I have not made my picks for that last night. I went 2-0, or I have not made my picks yet tonight. I did go 2-0 last night on both picks. I did pick the Lakers and the Kings. I wish I would have put more money on it than I did if I were a betting man, obviously, Diesel.
Yeah, you don't do that. It's not legal.
Yeah. That's right. It's
always
not
legal. Above the law.
Yes, right. Yes. So back to Cam Scott before we take a break and revisit with Jake Crain. We'll kind of spin this a different way, Diesel, than what we talked about in the first segment. Is South Carolina basketball, in your opinion, and I want to hear from the texters as well, 71307, start your text with the word fan, F-A-N. Phone lines open as well, 844-326-3663. Do you think men's basketball at all is benefiting from what Dawn Staley's done?
No, I don't. I mean, let me rephrase it. I think off the court, meaning fans in the stands, yes. I do think that it's made basketball an event worth going to.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it certainly helped. I mean, a year ago, 2 years ago, I mean, we remember, I think it was last year, there were reports that, you know, big donors at South Carolina were mad because they were bringing students from the upper deck down into their seats and filling seats that they weren't even going to take, going to use the tickets anyway. So that's where the program was in men's basketball. Women's basketball has been doing just fine attendance wise, but they were really struggling with attendance with men. And I think that certainly helps. It helps to engage students probably more than anything else. But on the court, I'd probably say no. I don't think it really has had much effect on the court with what Lamont Paris is. And I certainly don't want to take any credit away from Lamont Paris at all. He was really good at Chattanooga. That's why he got the job. And he gets brought down here, and he's able to continue it and keep it rolling. You love to see somebody who has shown the ability to do more with less, get more, and then watch them flourish.
Well, he's done just that. And, you know, he overachieved this year. We gave Carolina a hard time for getting blown out against Oregon, you know, in the tournament. But Diesel, you know, you said it at the beginning of the year, they couldn't sell tickets. That was this past year. They couldn't sell tickets. And then all of a sudden, doing more with less is exactly what he did. He turned the season around, and their roster this year wasn't the best. It wasn't the sexiest. It wasn't the flashiest. They had guys like BJ Mack, who came in as a grad transfer, right? Who really were big for that team, leading scorer most of the season. But if he can do that, to your point, if he can do that with what he had this year, man, let him get Cam Scott.
Yeah.
I said yesterday, I think Cam Scott's going to be incredible. He is one of those guys you watch play at the high school level, Diesel. You know how you can think like back in the years, back through the years for football, you watch that one spectacular football player play. For me, it was Marcus Lattimore at Burns. And when you watched him play high school, you just thought, oh, boy, you know, he's going to be playing on Sunday. And that's Cam Scott. I'll be honest with you. He's very similar in terms of when he's on the court, you can tell he's the best player on the floor. His not only his physical size, but the way that he plays, man, he's special. And you let him get into the college game and, you know, get better and learn. And South Carolina, they could be building something special.
Man, I'm interested. I'm really interested to see, you know, Cam Scott and Colin Murray Boyles teaming up together.
Mm.
I mean, that's going to be a really, really good mid-court game right there.
That'd be fun.
Meechie Johnson into the portal, correct?
Correct.
So you're going to be without Meechie Johnson. Outside of that, man, I'm looking to see like who's still going to be around, who's going to be able to provide that like big inside presence for South Carolina. BJ Mack is graduating. Meechie Johnson is gone.
Yeah.
Man.
Well, they do need a big guy.
They are a guard heavy team.
Yeah.
I mean, Colin Murray Boyles is listed as a forward at 6'7", 231, but I mean, their guards, a lot of their guards are sitting in that 6'4", 6'5", 6'7" range. Also, I mean, Talon Cooper gone. Outside of that, man, they're going to be rebuilding quite a bit next year as well. But hey, again, if you can keep a duo, like Colin Murray Boyles and
Scott
Cam Scott together for a couple of years,
mm-hmm.
you can a duo like that together can take you to the NCAA tournament. And if you add a piece or two around them via the portal, that's how you get to become an elite team.
I did get a message this morning, and again, there's no legs to this yet, but someone that's in the know more than I am in Columbia sent me this and said, this is something to watch. Nothing finalized, but to watch. Those were the exact words. And then it was the tweet that Nick Pringle has entered the transfer portal. I said earlier, Diesel, that I was very, very impressed with Nick Pringle in the tournament, especially with what he did against Clemson. You mentioned South Carolina kind of being guard heavy and needing a big guy. Boy, oh boy, if Lamont Paris could somehow land Nick Pringle, this team, this is a win now team, you know, because they need a big guy. And again, there's no legs to that, but I just was told this morning it's something to watch. We'll follow it. We'll see if Pringle has any interest, because you got to think, Diesel, if you're Pringle, don't you see a guy like Cam Scott that was committed to Texas, and now he goes to South Carolina, you're thinking, huh, something's in the water there. Colin Murray Boyles, something's in the water there.
Yeah,
maybe I want to go play.
It's called dollar bills floating around in the water.
Well, hey, if there's more dollar bills, they might want to see if he can Pringle them up.
Yeah, I mean,
how big would that be?
Yeah, that's huge. Again, like South Carolina seems to have been more willing at this point to throw around some money to get players to transfer in. We haven't talked about it. Again, there's no reason to believe that this is a legitimate option. But what if Pringle decided, you know what? Kind of like the cut of the jib that they got going on over there at Clemson. What if he headed there?
Yeah. That'd be big for Brownell. Brownell probably don't even know Pringle's in the portal.
Pringle? I get those on the chip aisle. What are you talking about?
Dabo, you got keys to that portal room? You got it? How terrible. That's awful. You know what? Like, let me tell you how bad it is. It's April the 17th. How many weeks are we removed from the final, the Elite Eight? Two, three?
2 weeks.
And I'm, as a Clemson, someone who grew up pulling for Clemson basketball and still do, I'm already over it.
But I thought he deserved a raise for this. I thought he deserved an instant.
I thought so. I mean,
yeah.
I'm already over it.
You already know where this is going to go. That's
sure,
the problem.
I do. I really
you
do.
You know where this is going to go. He's not going to make the tournament next year. NIT Brad.
God, that's sad though, man. It's sad that I am sitting here in April. We're in April, and I'm already talking about how I'm already like the Elite Eight, as great as it was, it should have been
rear view.
Yeah, it should have been something that catapulted the team.
You should
and
still be buzzing about it.
Well, you know what it should do? It should bring star players in,
but it's not.
I mean, they've got Chase Hunter, by the way. Chase Hunter gone. That's a huge loss.
Yep.
Who was the kid today that said that he was going to go play for Big Bad Brad? I'm pulling his name up. Transfer, obviously. Chase Hunter left. That's a big, big blow. Oh, here it is. Cincinnati transfer big man, Victor Lakin. L-A-K-H-I-N. Am I saying it right? Lakin?
Sounds right.
Has committed to Clemson, he tells On3 Sports. The 6'11 junior averaged 9.2 points per game and 6 rebounds per game this season. He played in Cincinnati. I have done a little research on Lakin. He is a big man, and he does look to be someone that will be very beneficial. However, you know what he can't do? He can't shoot the three ball. He can't do what P.J. Hall did. P.J. Hall could step back and shoot, right? That worries me.
He's a role player.
He's definitely not a...
He's more of a Godfrey than a Hall.
Yeah, but he's gone too.
Godfrey's gone.
That's bad, man. I'm frustrated.
You should be able to circle the wagons.
You should be able to say, hey, look what the Elite Eight brought us. Do. Instead, R.J. Godfrey said, yeah, we're going to build on this. 2 weeks later, peace up. Yeah, that's pitiful. I'm so done.
At this point, you better be bringing R.J. Godfrey back if he wants back. It's embarrassing to do it.
Do it. You got to.
But hey, if he wants to come back, you got to let him come back. Hey, we had a fantastic conversation earlier in the show with Jake Crain from Crain and Company, one of the fastest growing shows on YouTube, sports content like you won't get anywhere else. We would love for you to hear it again next. I'm Diesel. He's Cole Bryson. This is the Fan Upstate, 97.7 FM in Greenville, 97.1 FM in Spartanburg, wherever you are on the Odyssey app. And of course, whatever platforms you like to podcast on, the Odyssey app, on Spotify, on Apple Podcasts, on Google Podcasts. Do us a favor. Find us on whichever one you like the best and hit follow, hit subscribe, and meet us there.
for that one. But, dude, David, I've never been to a Dave & Buster's. I feel like I need to go. I've never been to one.
I feel like you, of a lot of people that I know, Jake, would be distracted by bright, shining, and flashing lights. If that's you, then you're going to love it. Giant Mario Kart, you know, friends and enemies are made and lost right there on that game alone.
You had me a giant Mario Kart. I mean, I'm like a fly to a light anyway, but you give me giant Mario Kart and I'll see you in a couple months.
Jake, was it a bad look by the WNBA to essentially uninvite OutKick from their birthday party? Like, wouldn't it have been better to grant them their credential request and continue granting credential requests in the future, allow them to spend their money flying all over the country to send people to press conferences, and then just never call on them? I think it was a small-time look by the WNBA.
Well, I mean, you know, for an organization that needs as many eyeballs as humanly possible and has kind of caught lightning in a bottle, at least a little bit at the college level with what we saw with the ratings of this past NCAA tournament, it's just that the amount of stupidity never ceases to amaze me when it comes to really big organizations in general. But if they were really smart, they would actually engage in the conversation to drive more eyeballs to their sport. But they're not, because they want to censor out anything they don't agree with. And that's one of the reasons why this is just going to be a flash in the pan and not a buffet you can go to all the time.
Hey, I want to keep it on topic with the WNBA for a minute, Jake. I saw the interview earlier today with Caitlin Clark on the Pat McAfee Show, and I don't know why, but all the interviews I've seen with Caitlin, no one is asking her the one question that I want to know. I want to ask you, in your opinion, when Caitlin Clark goes away from college basketball and the Angel Reeses of the world leave college basketball, do you feel like that college basketball is going to have a huge problem staring them in the face with trying to replace these stars?
Well, look, I mean, it's just like anything. It's like losing weight. The hard part isn't losing the weight. It's keeping it off. Now that they've garnered this attention, you are losing an absolute superstar who's going to have to take a pay cut in Caitlin Clark. And it wasn't just because of the way she played, but look at the controversies and kind of the villains that were created around her, and some could even consider her a villain herself. I think what made women's college basketball so intriguing is not just Caitlin Clark, that's a huge part of it, but you did have multiple teams that played about as high level of ball as you're gonna see at the women's level. You know, it used to just be UConn beating everybody to death, and that got old and nobody wanted to watch that. Well, now you had Iowa, driven heavily by Caitlin Clark. You had South Carolina, you had LSU, you had USC with Juju there. So there were multiple teams that could give you good games and matchups. Losing Caitlin Clark is going to hurt on many levels. And again, it's not about reaching the top. It's about how do you sustain it. I think we will see a dip because you are losing kind of a generational eyeball getter in Caitlin Clark. Not that Paige Beckers is going to be fun to watch, that's true. But the amount of teams that can compete at a high level, I think you're going to go back and take a dip. So I do think it's unsustainable. That's why all the hate that she's catching and banning people like OutKick is such a stupid move, because you're not striking while the iron's hot. You're actually striking people away while the iron's hot.
Jake, to follow up on that, why do you think so many major sports leagues struggle to generate new stars? I mean, you know, you look at a guy like Tiger Woods, he was certainly lightning in a bottle for his era and what he was able to accomplish. Caitlin Clark is another example of that. But once these players inevitably fall off as they age, we're seeing a lot of leagues really struggle to create new stars. Yes, Scottie Scheffler is a fantastic golfer, but he can't transcend the game the way that Tiger Woods did. I mean, is it just that there's no marketing budget big enough to create a star out of somebody who ultimately isn't the kind of star that they need?
Well, look, I think everything's cyclical, right? Like, you can only – there's a reason that some of these athletes are termed generational, because they only come once or twice a generation. It's going to be hard for anybody to elevate the sport of golf the way that Tiger Woods did, because, number one, he had the opportunity and he kind of had the backstory, right? When you look at Caitlin Clark and women's college basketball, it's a little bit of the same thing. It's being able to not only have that generational star, but hopefully that generational star creates more generational stars The biggest thing is it's just like the transfer portal. You can only operate with what the market bears, right? You can't go out there and try and create a star, because when you do that, most of the time they fall flat on their face. And it's not just about having stars, right? The NBA has stars, but as an organization, the NBA has alienated so many people politically that it's hard for them to market any star, because they have to fit in some pigeonhole narrative and believe certain things. That's why you just kind of have to hope, and when you do get those stars, you've got to be able to market them well. That's one thing that is, you know, been a big struggle for Major League Baseball, is that they have stars, they just don't know how to market them. That's one of the reasons I think Shohei Ohtani is going to slide on this betting thing, is because he's the Major League Baseball's golden hope to be able to market their game, not only here, but internationally. So again, it's just operating with the tools that you have. Some organizations do it better than others.
You can find him on Twitter at Jake Crain, that's C-R-A-I-N _. Did you ever think that you would be covering sports in a time, Jake, where we saw a NBA player banned from the game?
Well, I mean, banned from the game in general, nothing would surprise me when you see some of the off the field and on the court antics that we see. But as far as the gambling part of it, I didn't ever think sports gambling was going to be legalized like this. So I really didn't have that perspective. But when you think about it, I'm surprised, honestly, now that it hasn't happened more. But it does happen. They just go through third parties. It's just like it's getting caught. Like the way some of these guys are getting caught, you've got to be the dumbest person alive. It's like these people that are mega rich. It's like Patrick Mahomes' dad. Man, if you're going to get drunk, will you call an Uber? Your son's worth $1 trillion. Like Deshaun Watson. No, you're a star NFL quarterback. You don't got to go to Madame Kamei's palace. And even if you wanted to, where are all your friends at? Like, at some point, it's just stupid, man.
Is the Jontay Porter story, Jake, proof that maybe Charlie Baker is right in his attempt to, you know, get rid of all player props in college athletics?
I think if you're going to let people gamble, you got to keep the player. People are going to find a way to go around the rules. Like, you're never going to stop that. They already tried that with Prohibition, and look how that worked. I think you find the best way to regulate it, right? And then you have a deterrent like the NBA. You're banned for life, buddy. Pete Rose, you're banned for life. There is not a stronger deterrent than banning somebody for life. It's not changing the rules. It's putting together deterrents in place. The same thing with the bail laws. Well, if you arrest somebody and you let them out for bail regardless, they're going to go back and commit more crimes. But if there's a strong deterrent, you're going to minimize the bad behavior. You'll never eliminate it, but you'll minimize it.
Jake, I'm not sure how big of a baseball guy you are, but I do want to switch gears here a little bit and bring up...
Oh, big. Played in college.
Well, now that's great, because you must love, if you played in college, you must love having guys like Angel Hernandez behind you. Are you okay with if we go ahead and bring this thing up from AAA to Major League and go ahead and implement RoboOps?
Yeah, just as long as there's a human being that we can argue with.
Yeah.
Right? Like, I don't want a coach having to go out there and try and fight C-3PO. Like, I want somebody in human form to be able to yell at and point at and scream at. As long as we have that, I'm fine. What I don't want is challenging pitches like they do in the minor league. We're already here all day, right? We're here 162 regular season games, 9 innings. We don't need to make it last longer. Angel Hernandez has got to have pictures of somebody in Major League Baseball.
Gotcha.
He's got to have pictures of – he had to Epstein somebody. He's got pictures of somebody doing something, because there's no way you can be this bad for this long without either being a troll or having some blackmail art on somebody.
Jake, I can't get a read these days on Deion Sanders. Is he the most liberal or the most conservative coach in college football? And I don't mean that in a political stance. I mean, you know, being player-focused versus being, you know, NCAA and institution-focused. He'll make flashy statements. He'll tell his players to get in the portal because you're not going to have a spot on this team. But then he'll also rip into his team for not going to class and making life hard on the professors. I can't figure out where this guy is. And in your mind, is that by design?
Well, I think Deion Sanders is where whatever's going to generate the most interest in what Deion Sanders is doing. Like, that's what he's going to say. I don't think he's worried about being a hypocrite. I mean, we see it all the time. You see in politics, just to play, people say one thing when one person's in power, then somebody else in power, they'll say the exact opposite thing, knowing full well they're on video saying the exact opposite. So I don't think Deion Sanders has any shame. The problem now, though, is with the transfer portal, I thought Deion Sanders was bringing his Louis with him. Apparently his luggage got checked and got lost somewhere in Saudi Arabia or something.
So, Jake, you piqued my interest. I did not know that you played college baseball. I apologize for that. So while Diesel was asking the question, I did do a little research, and I am going to read a quote here. I have a question. It's got to be answered right now. A quote from your college baseball coach at South Alabama. And it says, Jake's an outstanding young man. He worked hard this fall. He swung the bat well, but needs to improve his speed. So I have to know, did you ever improve your speed?
Man, I did. The problem was my rotator cuff in my shoulder and my labrum basically looks like a number three on the Arby's menu right now. No, coming out of high school, man, I actually broke my foot my senior year and played the back half of my senior year, basically having to take two Loratabs and drink a Gatorade and just try and make it through it. So I was never the fastest. You'll never confuse a crane with being fast, but it did improve. Too bad my shoulder looks like a roast beef and cheddar right now.
Jake, you know, judging from the video that Lane Kiffin posted that you retweeted from the Ole Miss spring game, I've never wanted to be a Labrador Retriever so much in my entire life. But what a life to be that dog. Who's jumping the shark in terms of spring games? Who's going way too far and turning it into just to a completely nonsensical event?
Well, I mean, Ole Miss. I mean, they did the most out-of-the-box thing, which I don't hate. Look, the spring game at the end of the day should be played against another opponent. I firmly believe that. There's only so much you're going to get out of an actual spring game. It's like the Senior Bowl. The practices matter way more than the spring game. I like it, but the first person who gets hurt doing a reverse windmill dunk and you're starting at safety for me, then we have a problem. But as far as the dog video, take that, Tita. How do you like that? Yeah, let me hear you now. Nobody listens, but like my dog.
You'll do a custom outro?
Civilized world.
Yeah.
Jake, between your two co-hosts, David Cohn and Blaine Crain, who's running the bases at full sprint and collapsing rounding third?
Oh, man. Well, you know, Blaine's still single, so he's the one who hits the gym the most. Cone's a father of three now, and they're all under three, so I don't think he'd make it past second.
He is Jake Crain at Jake Crain _. Look up his show, Crain and Company. It's on YouTube. It's on Spotify. It's everywhere you want to look for your sports content. But Jake, man,
that was Jake Crain from Crain and Company. Find him at Jake Crain _. The Real Daily Wire, man, what they do over there is just fantastic, fantastic work. When we come back, we'll get you a quick preview on the show for tomorrow. Run you through today's Daily Wires one more time so you can keep up with what's going on out in the world. Man, the information never stops, so we will get you caught up with what's going on out there. That's next here on Wire to Wire. He's Cole Bryce, and I'm Diesel. We are the Fan Upstate.
Lost it there for a split second.
Strap in. We're going full throttle. Crimp it and rip it, baby. Yeah.
You're going wire to wire with Diesel and Cole Bryson on the Fan Upstate.
I'm Chuck Sanders. Here's the Sports Flash presented by Progressive. On the ice, the Blue Jackets beat the Hurricanes 6-3 last night. Carolina is playoff bound. They finished second in the Metropolitan Division. They rested eight regulars in the meaningless regular season finale. The Hurricanes reached the postseason for the sixth consecutive year. College baseball, Tuesday, number six, Clemson,
right,
beat Charlotte 8-5. Number seven, Duke with a 2-1 win over Gardner Webb. Number 19, Coastal Carolina beat number 11, North Carolina 5-4. Number 12, Wake Forest.
What can we do for tomorrow, Prima?
Number 20, South Carolina 4-3
win. I'm going to say we're going to do a transfer portal update.
Atlanta put up four runs at the top of the ninth. Reynaldo Lopez struck out seven over six scoreless innings. Orlando RC.
I'll come in the middle and do a second,
and the sack fly.
Eastern Conference play-in.
Starts for Atlanta.
Yep.
Bundle auto and home, renters or condo.
And let's see here.
Download the Odyssey app. Search for Odyssey and listen anywhere on your phone.
Chuck Sanders, that's the sports. Oh, we'll go with the what I already got at 345. What's the fastest land animal you can outrun? A highly motivated Cole Bryson would outrun this land animal.
I'll think about that.
Well, I'm gonna go and research and see like how fast are certain land animals. Like pigs can run 11 to 12 miles an hour. So if there was a pissed off pig coming at you, you think you could outrun a pissed off pig? Usain Bolt ran, what, like 21 miles an hour?
Yeah.
He's the fastest man alive. Most humans can sprint about 18 miles an hour.
My last, I did a 40.
Can't sustain it.
At the end of football season, I did a 40. 40-yard dash. And it was, let's see. Member FDIC. What was my 40 time?
As the nation's leader in using orthobiologics to deal with joint pain, QC Kinetics has treated tens of thousands of patients.
For many of them, that treatment comes with a plan to lose weight. As we know that keeping a healthy weight puts less strain on your joints.
So now to help patients lose weight in the fastest and most effective way, QC Kinetics is excited to offer newly approved injectables for those who qualify.
If your weight is keeping you from living your best life,
I thought I took a screenshot.
And learn more
about these next generation. My last 40 time was 5.76. So if I could run,
looking to look better and feel better by getting back,
I think I could beat a pig.
Call the medical professionals at QC Connect.
5.76 is faster than one quarterback.
And effective treatments.
QC is making these amazing options accessible and affordable. And it starts with a free consultation.
Call 833-QCK-SLIM to get yours today. Lose the weight now and finally give your aching joints a break. Call 833-QCK-SLIM. That's 833-QCK-SLIM.
When people have a craving to explore new and traditional Asian cuisines, they head to P.F. Chang's, where scratch-made dishes come from a 2,000-year-old tradition of wok cooking. P.F. Chang's wanted to explore new possibilities for their website. They turned to AmericanEagle.com. AmericanEagle.com re-architected P.F. Chang's website, integrating multiple third-party systems to create a unified digital experience. The results? Improved page speed and performance, personalized content based on users' location,
with Cole Bryson and Diesel on the Fan Upstate.
The Atlanta Braves won today. They have completed the sweep of the hated Houston Astros. It's a good song right here, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Makes you just want to.
Makes me want to dance.
Makes you want to. Like, this song should only be played on Friday. Yeah. Because it makes it, you feel, I don't know, it's just, it's got a good vibe. It's not a Wednesday song. There's nothing to look forward to on Thursday. Remember the best day of the week?
We're on the downhill stretch now, pal.
Remember what I told you? The best day of the week is Friday. So,
I'm still not buying it, man. You Friday like it? Is the best day of the week. You still got to go to work on Friday. You got to get up. You got to set the coffee pot. You got to set the alarm.
Yeah.
You don't drink. I don't know how you people who don't drink coffee do it in the morning. There I am saying you people again. I don't know how
you people do it. I'm not a coffee drink. Now, when I say I'm not
a whole pot every day.
No, I like it. I like coffee. I'm just not a, like, for whatever reason.
You don't need it.
I don't need it. I don't need it. I have to have it with some sort of cream and sugar and Splenda or something. Cream and Splenda. I can't do it black. Now, I will tell you this. I did find something the other day. I have started drinking it more. By the way, I got this in Ingles. Over, if you go to Ingles, it's, you know, like where the alcohol section is and you keep going and they have like the butter and cheese and stuff, I believe is where it was. Mm-hmm. They had coffee, cold brewed coffee that came in like a jug. So I bought it and it's just straight black coffee. I did not think I would like it. Mm-hmm. However, as you know, I like it iced rather than hot. So in the mornings, I've been pouring it over ice, and it's actually good.
Well, cold brew is different. I mean, it takes longer to use a term for like steep.
Uh-huh.
You're kind of steeping the coffee the way you would steep a tea bag, right?
Yeah.
Like it's in cold water, so it takes longer for the flavors to come out.
I liked it.
It's probably not as harsh.
No, it's not.
I don't know exactly how they make. I love hot coffee. Oh, give me like. Here's people are going to be fascinated to hear about this. This is great radio, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I get up, first cup of coffee, I always put a little bit of sugar in it. And I've been reducing over the years, reducing the amount of sugar I put in my first cup. Sure. Second cup, and every cup for the rest of the day, black.
Mm.
Like I need that little extra juice.
Just make that first one.
Cup a little more palatable. So it hit you right in the face. But no, and after that, it's all black.
I don't mind it. And listen, if you go to like a Starbucks or wherever and you get mocha or something like that, obviously I'll drink that because
it's got a lot of chocolate.
It's got a lot of chocolate.
Delicious.
And, you know, all that crap that you don't need in it. So I'm all for it. I'm all for it if it has sugar and whipped cream and chocolate and caramel. But
I used to be a Frappuccino dude. Can't do them anymore.
You don't like
them? No. I mean, there's almost no coffee in them, right? You know,
that's why I like it.
All sugar and flavor.
I tell you what I get is like on Saturday mornings during the fall at the Scramble locations for Ingles, I'll get the white chocolate mocha with a pump of vanilla. And
you ever done a black and white mocha?
No.
Change your life.
No. I don't even know what a mocha is. I just know
it's a latte with chocolate in it.
I just know it's good. It's really good. It's not healthy, though.
No. It's one of those things the Italians would look down on us.
Why is that?
Tight pants and small shoes. And
oh, they don't drink that kind of
stuff. They'd be like, oh, you drink. It's a terrible Italian accent. I don't know how to do it now. You stupid Americans.
They don't drink frou-frou coffee?
I don't think they do. Everything else they do is frou-frou, but not their coffee. They take that seriously.
Hmm. That's something I just learned.
Texter got in on our topic about an hour ago. We were talking about the Raptors player who got himself banned for life. Jontay Porter got himself banned for life for violating the NBA's gambling policy. We were talking about who was the player who got himself arrested in China for shoplifting. It was LiAngelo Ball.
Of course it was.
Which, yeah, of course it was. It was one of the ball boys.
One of the balls. All right, I wanted to close the show with this. I did have Sunday, we were at Rob Brown's house watching the Masters. I came home, and by the time I got home, it was about a 50-minute drive. I got home. And I think they were on hole, I don't know, 16. So I was flipping back and forth between the Masters and the NASCAR race. Because the only – when I watch a race, the only part of the race I can watch is like the last 40 laps. I just cannot do the other meaningless –
It's a cut-the-grass sport.
It is.
Watch the first 20 laps, go cut the grass, yep. Come inside, watch the last 40 laps.
The first 350 or whatever it is meaningless. It's boring. I can't do it. So anyways, each Sunday I do watch. I'll watch the last 40, give or take. So I get home, flipping back and forth between, and the last 15 laps. Texas Motor Speedway, not a really interesting track, nothing spectacular about it. It's a large track, but I think the last 15 laps took over 30, 35 minutes. There were probably, I don't know, I'm going to get this wrong, but it felt like there were 7 cautions in the last 20 laps. And a buddy of mine who's a big NASCAR fan loves it. Like, he loves restarts. He loves cautions. He loves mixing it up and having this driver start on the outside, and all of a sudden this driver on the inside has a chance now to pass. I hate them. I can't stand a restart. I don't know why. When I watch a race.
You don't like to boogity, 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 let's go racing?
No. When I watch the last 40 of a race, perfect world for me would be when the 40 hits and we're getting down to the finale, I'm okay with one caution. But when you get down to like 20, I don't want any more freaking cautions. It is ridiculous. Next time you just want to get pissed off, turn on a race with like 25 laps to go, and you'll see caution after caution after caution. It is the most ridiculous way to end a sport. I don't know how to fix it.
What sucks about it is these teams, you know, they budget fuel for the last 20 laps, 30 laps, 40 laps, whatever it is. They budget tires for that reason. And then you have cautions, and that just blows all that to hell. Right?
It's like awful.
They had worked for how many laps to get into the positioning that they were in?
Yeah.
And then a caution just goes and changes it. Chaos at the last minute. And then it puts somebody who's close to running out of fuel, you know, out of gas. Or it takes a team that maybe screwed up and didn't budget enough fuel. Now they have an opportunity to go in and get more gas, especially
sure.
if the whole field takes the caution flag. I get what you're saying.
I guess some people like it because, like, if they have a driver that's anywhere from 2 to 5 or 6, it feels like it gives their driver a chance to maybe win the race.
It does bunch everybody back up.
It does. And I get that part of it. But, for example, I'll tell you, to your point, here's where I'd be pissed off. If I was a guy like Denny Hamlin Sunday, he ran a perfect race. Denny Hamlin ran probably the best race of anyone Sunday at Texas. The whole race, he was right there at the leaderboard, right? Top 5 the whole race, pretty much, give or take. Well, the very last, next to last lap, Chase Elliott, who wins the race, some people say he didn't, but Chase Elliott got in his corner a little bit. Then he spins out, hits the wall, caution with a lap to go. Mm-hmm. Well, at that point, the standings are final after the checkered lap or after the white flag comes out, right? So it's interesting to think, like, for someone who Denny Hamlin, he ran a perfect race the whole race, and he's going to win the race. But because something happened with 1 or 2 freaking laps to go, all of a sudden, you know, that's why I think NASCAR is a unique sport, because you can win a whole perfect race, but if it don't go your way in those last 2 laps.
Oh, man, as a kid, I used to love watching, you know, Dale Earnhardt spin somebody out on the last lap. It was great. You don't want to get
stay
half a car length ahead.
Madcraft says, you just want me to sit in 7th and deal with it? Hell no, I'm passing someone, and if we wreck, we wreck. Well, Madcraft, that's why you're not a NASCAR driver.
And then
there'd be a caution every lap.
Yeah, but you know, if you get wrecked out on a situation like that very often, you're going to have a chance to wreck somebody out as well on a situation like that. Like, it's just all a jumble. It's a mad jumble right there at the very end.
I just hate
when it's a wreck outside of the top 10, outside of the top 15, that really doesn't affect the race, right? The top 5,
yeah, that sucks.
They've spread themselves out. You know, somebody's got a 3-4 second lead on somebody, which is significant with a couple laps to go. And then somebody back in 30th causes a caution.
Yep, that's true.
And
that
then
sucks.
That changes the outcome.
It does.
That changes the end of the race.
That's where it does get aggravating. And real quick, you're going to close the show in a second, but I want to read this that somebody sent me, a buddy of mine, about Jontay Porter. It was an article on ESPN, right? Well, this guy shared the article, and this is the last thing I'll say today. The lifetime suspension of Jontay Porter, let me get the name right, is brought to you by DraftKings, America's number one sports book. Use the code Jontay Porter for a 20% deposit match up to $500 on your first bet. Must be 21 or older in select states.
You know full damn well, if we got a call tomorrow that said, hey, DraftKings wants to sponsor Wire to Wire, we'd be reading the hell out of that liner.
Yeah.
We are all whores in this business. We will do anything for a buck. Yes, we will. Hey, coming up tomorrow on the show, we're going to get deep into the transfer portal. Who's out there 2 days into the transfer portal? Who's lost the most and who could stand to gain? We'll talk about that tomorrow on Wire to Wire. Madcraft, appreciate you being here for the entire show. And yeah, hot mics, man, that's going to happen because, you know, we have to engineer things to where we open up the mic on our StreamYard streaming platform so that you can hear the audio, but at the same time, mute ourselves on the board in here to make sure you don't hear us. So every now and again, we're going to make that mistake. But hey, you just get a little extra show. That's all there is, man. Hey, appreciate you watching throughout the entire day, and we'll see you Tolos tomorrow.